Welcome to Fort Valley State University, home of the Wildcats, and here's the Centennial Monument at the center of this historic campus. We welcome you inside Wildcat Stadium in Fort Valley, Georgia. It's college football out of the SIAC this afternoon. The Maroon Tigers of Morehouse roll in to face the Fort Valley State Wildcats.
Take it to the max.
Atlanta. And the weather obviously is going to be a huge factor here. And you see the buckets of sunshine that are pouring down. We're looking for temperatures. Maybe the high temperature might be a little north of that. Maybe as high as 95 today. No wind to speak of. Sunny and hot, and it's going to be that way all day long.
Yes, it will. You have to think, if it's 95 degrees in the air down in that football field, it's about 105, 110 degrees. Dark uniforms, pads, helmets. So these guys' conditioning is going to be a big question today. See who's in the best shape. The guys stay hydrated, and hopefully nobody pulls a hamstring or anything with all this heat.
Morehouse has won the toss. They have deferred to the second half. Fort Valley State will get the ball first. And speaking of this heat, DeAndre Clark, you can see him out there in the suit with the bow tie. During fall camp, they had their practices between 1 and 2. They wanted to be out here in the hottest part of the day to really make conditioning a big part of their program. They like this weather. They're gunning for it.
And down here in Georgia, this part of Georgia, I mean, you can't hide from it. You go outside, it's going to be hot, so the kids might as well. It's a good strategy by the coach, getting the guys out there used to it, because you can't run from it. You have to play in it, so you might as well be prepared for it.
Thank you, sir.
Richard Freeman is the head coach at Morehouse in his second season. And you can see back to receive this kick. Keep your eye on number 7, Ricardo Lockett. He took the second half kickoff last week at Clark Atlanta, all the way back for a 76-yard touchdown. Kicking off for Morehouse will be Micah Strife. He'll handle all the kicking chores, kicking off, punting, and the place kick as well. Maroon Tigers in their road whites, trimmed in maroon. Fort Valley in the blue, trimmed in gold, and we are underway. And this one is going to go all the way back to the goal line and will be picked up across the 10, 15, 20. And that's Dorian Giles, and Giles may take this one to the house. Giles going to take it. That's going to be officially 100 yards on the kickoff return for a touchdown, but a flag is down back at the 8-yard line.
If that play stands, that is a huge way to start a football game, to get your team into it, but we don't know what this penalty is. It's in the back. It may be a block in the back.
It's a holding penalty against Fort Valley State. So take it off the board. A 100-yard kickoff return. You're going to have to take that one down. Dorian Giles, a sophomore from Stone Mountain, Georgia, had a little trouble getting the handle on that ball, but when he did, the penetration of the special teams unit from Morehouse overran the play, and he took it back 100 yards, but take it off the board. Here's the offense for Fort Valley State. The quarterback is Garrett Williams, a senior. He's taken every snap through the first two games. Leading into the game against Clark Atlanta, he had a bit of an eye infection, and that bothered him during practice. He had some swelling last week, but he is back at nearly 100%.
He had some problems fielding that kickoff returning. It looked bad from the beginning, but he turned it out pretty at the end. But too bad it got called back for a penalty.
Stockbridge, Georgia, transfer from Savannah State. And this offensive set will begin from the 3-yard line. Handoff. And did Brown get out of the end zone? Yes, he did, but he lost 2 yards on the play. So the first handoff to Pierre Brown, and he is dropped for a 2-yard loss. Let's take a look at the lineups. Backs and receivers for Fort Valley State: Pierre Brown, Lockett at 191 all-purpose yards last week. Up front, Colin Cordell at the center may be the best of a veteran group. And a shout out to Rodney Patterson's family in San Bernardino, California. We know you're watching, and we know you got about 30 people around the TV this afternoon. He definitely wants to put on a good show. Second down and a dozen. Again, going to keep it on the ground. And the center of that Morehouse line is up to the challenge. It's going to be third down and long. And again, the carry goes to Brown, the senior from New Haven. Let's go ahead and take a look at Morehouse's defense. Up front, Tristan Taylor is going to start at the left tackle spot. Jamal James will be there. Mario Lane is suspended for the first half of this game. We anticipate we'll see him in the second half. We told you about the linebackers. Cargyle's outstanding. Brandon Cunningham had a 48-yard fumble return last week. And in the secondary, you've got upperclassmen on the corners. Gabriel Harper at the strong safety spot. Throws incomplete. And the quarterback, Williams, was in the grasp. And no flag. Yep. What do you think, Doug? Could this have been a safety?
That definitely could have been a safety. You see the play action, and he's right in his face. He just throws it away. I mean, it's there's actually a receiver in the area. So the referee may have seen a blue jersey in the direction where he was throwing the football, but that's a pretty close call.
Jake Grubbs has his back foot on the back end line of the end zone. This should be tremendous field position for Morehouse. Got the kick away. Takes a Fort Valley hop, fielded at the 40-yard line, and back to the 38. On the return goes Tyderick Williams.
You know, and Dave, and that series right there shows what a penalty can do to a team. And you know, you start the game off with a opening kickoff for a touchdown. It gets called back. You get backed up. You don't get anything going on offense. And now you give the ball right back to Morehouse with great field position. So hopefully Morehouse can do something with this field position and score. Good for them. Bad for Fort Valley with them not getting that 6 points from that original kickoff return.
Gerald Cook, the junior from Pleasant Grove, Alabama, will start at quarterback. Played most of the way last week, but was knocked out of the game at Benedict with a shot to the ribs. Great field position. This is a football team, Doug, that has not scored an offensive touchdown yet. They'll go from a one-back set, first and 10 from the Fort Valley 38. And just before the snap, we've got a penalty on the play. Is something you definitely do not want to do in this situation. Morehouse would love to get an early touchdown, take advantage of this tremendous field position to start this game.
As Morehouse has been a little beat up on offense, quarterback and running back have both been nicked up with injuries. So, you know, anything they can get, any help their defense can get by getting them the ball back in good field position definitely helps them.
Just 3 rushing yards last week in a loss at Benedict, just 152 total yards. First and 15 from the 43 now. And they will go from the gun. Cook, the throw incomplete. It was intended for Cameron Ford. Here's a look at our lineups. Backs and receivers for Morehouse. Christian Green will start at the tailback spot, and he is going to be playing with a shoulder harness. He had a slight separation last week. Offensive line, Ramon Harewood is probably one of the premier linemen in this conference. He's big today at the left tackle spot. Second down and 15. Out of the eye this time. Williams comes to the formation in the back again. And here's the handoff. Oh, big hit inside. Patrick Burns was absolutely waiting on Cameron Ford and just swallowed him up. And speaking of that defense for Fort Valley State, here's a look at their lineup. Hughes and Williams at the ends. Pengel is a standout inside at the defensive tackle spot. Amongst the linebackers, Trent Newton's a transfer, and he leads them currently in tackles. And in the secondary, Stephen A. Jackson's a big play guy, along with Bostic on the other corner. Good time for that throw. Incomplete, however. Tried to go right up the seam. Seen to McFadden, incomplete. So Morehouse unable to move the football, unable to take advantage of that great field position.
And they bring Stephen A. Jackson on the blitz on that play, and it got picked up nicely. It looked like he had two receivers in the same part of the field. I'm not sure if there was some confusion on the route running, but that play, it could have gotten a better result, but they had two guys in the same area. Seemed to be some confusion. It ended up being an incompletion.
Strife back to punt. He is the conference co-special teams player of the week. Last week in a loss, averaged 39 yards per punt, put 3 inside the 20. He'd love to do that again right here. Good kick, but it will go into the end zone for a touchback. And we'll take a timeout right now. We are underway at Fort Valley State. The Wildcats of Fort Valley will start their second possession from their own 20 when we return in just a moment. No score. Welcome back to Fort Valley, Georgia. College football this afternoon on ESPNU, Morehouse and Fort Valley State. And if you've missed the opening moments of this one, you've already missed a lot. You've seen a 100-yard kickoff return to open this game called back. Morehouse on their first possession started first and 10 from the Fort Valley 38. Could not take advantage. DeAndre Clark, he's the guy in the bow tie, the head coach for Fort Valley. He's got to love that. Out of the eye line. And that carry goes to Skylar Thornton. First carry for him. Spent a couple of years at Florida, now a senior. Leading rusher from LaGrange, Georgia. Averaging 4.1 yards per carry. And Cargyle, he will be in the middle of everything. And what a program he comes out of. St. X, St. Xavier in Cincinnati.
That's a big tackle by Cargyle also, because if he doesn't get Thornton by the feet right there, that would have been a big game. Thornton cut it back, there's a nice hole, but Cargyle closed in quickly and made the play.
Run out of the eye right now with Maurice Dorsey at the fullback spot. Garrett Williams, the senior, under center. Second down and three. This will be Thornton again. And Thornton is brought down by Earl Thomas. They are hitting in the middle of that line.
Yes, they are. You got an eight-man front. I mean, there's a lot of bodies around the line of scrimmage. It's going to be tough to run that football. So Fort Valley State is going to have to come off the football, move somebody around, get some seams for these running backs. So it's going to be a long day.
Talking to DeAndre Clark yesterday, he'd like to get some continuity going on both sides of the line of scrimmage for this one. Last week for Clark Atlanta, they had 9 players suspended for the first half of the game for lack of sportsmanship at the end of their season opening loss at Valdosta. That was not a conference suspension. He suspended his own players. Throw across the middle, tipped and nearly intercepted. It was Troy Shine who had both hands on the football and couldn't pull it in.
And Troy Shine is one of their big time DBs. He had 10 tackles last week. You know, and this is what's going to happen. When you play 8 men around the line of scrimmage, your corners and your DBs are going to have to play man. And this is what you do right here. You drop back in coverage, read the quarterback. Great play. Unfortunately, they couldn't get the interception, but they're going to dare Fort Valley to throw that football today.
Grubbs ready for his second punt of the game. And Williams is back to receive it. Flags in play.
Hey, you can be 4 down there.
We're going to pick that flag up, and we are set for play again. Grubbs, a senior from nearby Warner Robins. Good kick. This one's going to turn over. Williams is going to catch it on the fly at the 41-yard line. He's in the Fort Valley territory, across the 45 and down near the 42-yard line. So for the second time in as many possessions, Morehouse is going to start with on the Fort Valley side of midfield.
You know, once again, they get great field position, right? Let's see what they can do with it. And you see, he fields the punt, you know, hits the seam, no dancing around, gets north and south, makes a move, gets upfield, and puts Morehouse back in Fort Valley territory.
So Williams, after that punt return, going to stay on the field as a wide receiver.
Hey, come here.
You can see Fort Valley looking over to the defensive coordinator on their sideline to get the call. On first down, Cook's going to operate out of the gun. Strong left formation, trips to that side. Cook, right across the middle, passes caught, wide open. Down near the 30-yard line, that is a first down. And the catch is made by Williams.
And you see they come out with the trips formation to the top of the screen. They send one across the middle, one vertical, one to the left. The vertical route is running wide open. No, they must have gotten confused on defense. Makes a big catch. Moves the sticks. First down.
So Williams comes off the field after that first down play. Single back set this time. Blitz coming from Fort Valley. And he is swallowed up. Penn Gell with a big play in the middle of the line. Just absolutely nowhere to go for the tailback Cameron Ford. And so right now we've seen Ford a lot. We have not seen Christian Green.
We have seen Ford, and right here you see he gets the handoff of the left tackle, and he just gets swallowed up. They bring the blitz. They're trying to come after Morehouse and see what they can do on offense. Morehouse has not been successful on offense so far this season, so Fort Valley's going to blitz him. They're going to make a big play.
Pangel is a business major. He was all business on that tackle. Loss of one, second and 11. Line of scrimmage is the Fort Valley 29. Four wide this time. And coming from the backside on the blitz, big hit by Trenton Newton. Coming from his linebacker spot, and he lowered the boom on Gerald Cook, who never saw him coming.
Yeah, they brought Newton and they brought Jackson the other corner, and they both got there simultaneously. Newton got there a little quicker, and you can see these are the ones, these hurt.
Ooh.
These are how you get your quarterback. He gets high load, actually. And these are the ones you don't see. Those are the ones that hurt. Luckily, he was able to hold on to the football.
Well, last week in a loss, Morehouse used Cook, William Brack, and Christian Sterling all at the quarterback spot. And Cook won't be able to take that much punishment like that very many more times today. Third and 17. So Morehouse needs a big conversion to keep this drive alive. They've had tremendous field position here in the opening moments of this game. And we've got a timeout by Morehouse. That's the first here in the first half.
You know what, the inability Morehouse has had to be able to move the football, not just today, but this year, I'm not surprised that you can see sometimes on offense they have problems getting lined up. Not really, they don't have anything, they don't have a bread and butter. They're not known for passing right now, they're not known for running the ball. They're trying to find themselves offensively. I think that's caused a lot of confusion at the quarterback position. And a lot of the players don't know, they're not comfortable running anything on offense right now.
Get all your college football information on ESPNU Monday and Tuesday. First Monday at 7 Eastern, Lowell Galindo, Mike Gottfried, and Tom Luckenbill deliver Inside the Polls, presented by 76. All season long, they'll break down the polls and dissect the hot topics of the day. Who's overrated? Who's underrated? Who deserves to be number one? Then Tuesday at 1 Eastern, Lowell Galindo hosts Coach's Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual. See and hear how a team is doing straight from the head coach as we bounce around coaches' press conferences from all around the country. For more, log on to ESPNU.com. After the timeout, third and 17. Trips to the bottom of your screen. Here's Cook. Protection's good. Pass is caught. Reception is made by Unshailed Henji.
And that's what Morehouse is going to have to do. They're going to have to spread the field, keep a back end to protect, because they're having problems protecting Cook, and let him set up and look downfield and find an open receiver. Does a good job here. Henji comes across, makes a big catch, moves the chains, keeps this Morehouse drive alive.
He's a junior from Silver Spring, Maryland. Great basketball star in high school at Blake. And that's a big conversion. They convert on third and 17. And they move into the red zone at the 16-yard line to start this drive. Backs are split this time. Here's a deep handoff, one broken tackle, and that is the first handoff we have seen in this game to Christian Green, the junior from LA, and he finds little running room around the right end.
And once again, Fort Valley is bringing that blitz. Morehouse tried a screen earlier in the game. Wasn't successful, but if Fort Valley continues to blitz this way, the screen and draw is going to be big against this defense.
Well, they could use a big game from Green. Green had only three carries for 16 yards before he had to leave the game with a slightly separated shoulder at Benedict last week. In their only scoring drive for a field goal in the second quarter, he had a big 21-yard gainer in that drive. Second down and 9. Ball resting at the 15. No play action. Blitz coming from the side. Cook avoids it. Thrown to the back of the end zone. Out of bounds. Boy, Cook did a great job as it looked like Newton was going to collect his second sack of the first quarter. He stepped up and Newton slipped right behind him.
And they continue to bring these defensive backs on these blitzes. You see right here, comes from the blind side. He just doesn't wrap up. Cook steps over, delivers a ball, out of bounds. But luckily he avoided the big shot this time. And he's way out of bounds. He stretched out. Great effort on the catch, but the ball is just completely off the field of play.
Now Morehouse has already completed a third and 17 on this drive to keep it alive. Now it's third and 9 at the 15. Cook the pass again. Holding the ball into the end zone. Pass tipped. Incomplete.
Ball, 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 ball,
And once again, Cook's on the ground. And Fort Valley is getting into Morehouse's backfield, and they're getting a lot of pressure on Cook. I'm sure it's making him have little happy feet dancing around in the pocket. You see him step back here. He has time. He steps back, looks, delivers a ball, double coverage. Nowhere else for him to go but maybe throw it away. But lucky that wasn't intercepted.
Yeah, that was intended for James Stedman, and most of the time he's going to draw double coverage. He had four catches for 93 yards last week at Benedict and had a 38-yard touchdown called back. Strife missed two field goals last week but hit a 40-yarder. And the kick is good. That's a 32-yard field goal. And it puts Morehouse on the board. So the Maroon Tigers take advantage of the good field position. They bog down inside the red zone, but they convert on the field goal and they draw first blood here at Fort Valley. We'll take a break and come back. Morehouse with a 3-0 lead on the road at Fort Valley State.
It's time to turn a small
College football on ESPNU is brought to you by Jack Link's Beef Jerky. Feed your wild side. That's a Centennial Monument at Fort Valley State. You know, this is my first trip here, Doug. I know you're from Atlanta and you're relatively close to this area. I was aware of Fort Valley State as a Steeler fan, always a big fan of Greg Lloyd, who was a star here. But this is our first trip in here, and very nice campus, a good facility, and they'll be updating this football stadium, and we'll hear more about that from the university president at halftime.
Yes, they will. It's a very nice campus. We got a chance to see it on accident today, trying to find the stadium, but I enjoyed it. It's a very nice campus, and Greg Lloyd, I was a huge fan of his growing up, and he is an alumni of this university, and actually there's a couple guys in the pros from both of these schools.
Sure. Tyrone Poole, also one of the first stars of the Carolina Panthers, went to Fort Valley. Kickoff return, and that is Lockett. So Lockett takes it out to the 34-yard line. Good field position. You know, we anticipate seeing a lot of offense this afternoon from Fort Valley, but look at Morehouse. They've got the early edge there, 29-3.
Yeah, not huge, staggering numbers, but you do expect to see more offense from Fort Valley, especially with that two-headed rushing attack that they have. But I told you, that eight-man front of Morehouse is going to cause problems for any team that likes to run the football.
So Morehouse right now, they've lost 10 straight to Fort Valley State, but they're playing their kind of football, smash mouth, conservative. They'd like to win a defensive-minded game if they can. Williams on the play action, directing traffic, throws on the run, pass is caught. And the reception is made by Sean Jordan, junior from Riverdale.
And this is what Fort Valley's going to have to do. If they're going to put eight guys in the box and crowd the line of scrimmage and plug every guy, they're going to have to try play action. They're known to run the football, so you have to respect the play action. Get the quarterback out, get him in space, delivers a nice ball. And they're going to test those Morehouse defensive backs and see how good they really are today.
My mistake, that's Darius Williams, the junior from Decatur. That's his first catch of the year. First and 10 from the 47-yard line, out of the eye this time. And Williams is bowled over as the nose tackle just went right over the center. We're in Fort Valley, Georgia for college football out of the SIAC. Rod Holloway is our referee today. This is a 5-yard offsides penalty that will go against Morehouse. I'm Dave Weekly, happy to be alongside Doug Chapman today. And it is a blazer here in Georgia. Temperature around 94 degrees. We got some clouds, so occasionally we're going to get a little shade and maybe a little bit of a breeze, but not too much. And over on the Fort Valley sideline, we can see a portico unit, but we don't see any fans or anything on the Morehouse side.
The Morehouse has no fans. They have no portico. They just have water. So hopefully that's enough to get them through this football game.
Williams. That's his second catch of the year and his second catch in consecutive plays in this drive.
And sometimes that is just as good as a run play. You know, you throw the, it's like a long pitch. You throw the ball out to one of your playmakers, let him make a move in space, get upfield, get north and south, move the chains. If you can't run the football between the tackles, plays like that are just as good as running the football.
Williams is a man after my own heart. He wants to go to culinary school and wants to own his own restaurant and club.
He's a small fellow to go to culinary school. They never say trust a skinny, never trust a skinny chef, right?
That's right. Trying to keep that defense honest. This time the handoff goes to the fullback off the left side, Maurice Dorsey, sophomore from Harlem, Georgia. He's known as a very strong blocker, and he cracked the starting lineup late last year.
He goes 6'2", 230 pounds. He's a load to bring down. He's going to have to work his butt off today to keep those linebackers on Morehouse honest.
We anticipate we're going to see an awful lot of personnel on both sides of the ball from both teams because of the heat. We'll see Dorsey at the fullback spot. We also expect to see plenty of Brandon Anderson and Ron Maxwell. On second down and 7 from the Morehouse 40. Thornton is a wing to the left. Williams is split out wide to the right. Williams, one step back and sends it long for Lockett. He's got it. Touchdown, 40 yards. And just like that, Fort Valley State takes the lead.
And I like what I saw. The quarterback, he looks over. He recognizes man coverage. The safety walks over to the middle of the field. He sees he has the whole left side from the hash over. Audibles, gives the receiver a go route. And the result is 6 points. You see, he scans the field. He knew where he was going the entire time. Head never comes off the receiver. Can be dangerous, but if you see your guys beating him this bad, just put the ball up, let him go up and get it. Great play. Ricardo Lockett, big-time receiver, makes a big-time play right here.
It covered 40 yards, and it puts Fort Valley in front for the first time today. Grubbs is on to add the extra point. And so Fort Valley State comes back quickly offensively, and they take the lead. Lockett now with a touchdown catch for the second consecutive week. That one covered 40 yards. Fort Valley 7, Morehouse 3.
Here we are.
Request a complete prospectus or profile with investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information to RITS.
Well, Lockett on the receiving end of a 40-yard touchdown pass from Williams right before our commercial break. 7-3. Fort Valley with the lead, and that play capped a very quick and efficient drive. 4 plays, 65 yards in just over 2 minutes. And so Grubbs will kick off.
That's what they're going to have to do today. They're going to have to test Morehouse's defensive backs. They're going to crowd the line. You got to throw that football. That's going to happen.
Line drive. Oh, that ball looked like it was heading out of bounds. Instead, it was picked up. Oh, my. What a hit. Jamar Rodriguez cleaned out on a huge hit by Elliott Williams.
And right now, Fort Valley is playing with a little bit of swagger right now. Big hit, big hit. They're jacked up off the big touchdown. Comes back and just lights him up on the sideline.
Listen to this. All right, so Williams, the starting tight end. And, you know, at the Division II level, you see starters playing special teams a lot. And Williams with a huge hit. First and 10 from the 36-yard line. Morehouse now trailing for the first time. Handoff inside, and it's Christian Green, and we have got a new quarterback. So Christian Sterling, the junior from Houston, Texas, now in the game. Sterling's kind of an interesting story. He started his career as a preferred walk-on at Texas Tech. Last year spent a part of the year trying to get his grades in order. This year has been a much bigger part of the Morehouse attack. Played in the second half last week in their loss to Benedict. He's got the best arm of their trio of quarterbacks, and he is in the shotgun right now on second down. And that pass is caught. Quincy Avery makes the grab.
And they test that arm. Anybody that watches Texas Tech football knows that they love to throw the football. So if he's coming from a program like that, he's very accustomed to throwing the football. He's a guy the coach speaks very highly of, loves his arm. He's just probably trying to get in and learn this offense now and get comfortable. And right now, it looks like he's got no choice but to do so.
Avery's got good hands. He's a senior, but back at Washburn High School in Minneapolis, he was a high school quarterback, led his conference in receptions for 2 years. All right, here's Sterling on the run, stays behind the line of scrimmage. He's got a man behind the defense. Hengie's going to take it all the way for a touchdown. And that one's going 61 yards. So Morehouse, which has been offensively challenged the first week of the season, they've got 10 points on the board here early on the road at Fort Valley.
And Fort Valley has been blitzing the entire afternoon. You live by the blitz, you die by the blitz. And they bring it. They bring the backside blitz. Sterling remains calm, rolls out, doesn't panic, delivers a nice football down the field. The result is 6 points, touchdown. You can see he just gets behind everybody. They bring a couple cornerbacks, just leaves him playing man-to-man. Actually, a linebacker is chasing him down right now. So I'm not sure what kind of coverage they were in, but it's definitely a mismatch.
The extra point is up and good, so Sterling has an immediate Sterling impact, if you will, on this game. Directing traffic, don't know if that was a broken play. Looked like it was, Doug, as he rolled out to the right and then found Henshey behind the defense for six.
Yeah, the blitz definitely, Stephen A. Jackson coming again from that corner spot, made him roll out to his right. But once again, he didn't panic, didn't pull it down, kept his eyes downfield looking for a receiver. Delivers a catchable football, and the end result, touchdown. Morehouse is up now.
All right, so speaking of Morehouse, let's go ahead and take a look at their resume. A little bit more on the school, which is located in Atlanta. Established 1867, and basically known as the Black Harvard. And you can see the alumni, the enrollment just under 3,000. Martin Luther King, Spike Lee, Edwin Moses. You were telling me a pretty interesting story about the actor Samuel L. Jackson and his relationship with Morehouse as a student.
If I read correctly, Samuel L. Jackson was actually the team statistician for the swim team. And when I read that, I kind of chuckled because I just think of Samuel L. Jackson in Pulp Fiction and,
right.
You know, some other movies, and I just saw him taking stats for a swim team. He's kind of, you know, but you never know.
You never know.
I hope never
I didn't,
know.
I didn't mean to break your concentration by asking you that question. Kickoff coming, 10-7. Giles has already had a 100-yard kickoff return for score to start this game, called back. And this one he'll take out to the 25-yard line. Another look at Sterling's touchdown pass. Three plays, 64 yards in just under a minute. Henshey on the receiving end of a 61-yard pass. He didn't have to do too much on that one.
He didn't have to. He just kept himself alive. What happens when your quarterback starts to scramble around, your receivers are coached to keep a good relationship with your quarterback. That means get into his sight. If you see him rolling, don't stay covered. Move around, move where your relationship with him is good. We can find you. Quarterback finds him, delivers a good ball. Henshey takes it to the house.
Penalty against Fort Valley is going to move the ball back 5 yards, back to the 20-yard line. And DeAndre Clark still wearing the jacket. How he's doing that, I have no idea.
I admire him because I'm warm up here and we have AC, so I can imagine how hot it is down that field with a not just a suit, but a dark-colored suit with that.
And he's a defensive-minded guy, so he can't be very happy about that last touchdown pass. Pitch to the wide side. Here comes Brown. Flag is down. And Brown goes out of bounds into the Fort Valley bench area at the 32-yard line. But this one is coming back.
Looks like there may have been a hold. That's how he was able to get that corner so easily. I think I may have seen a hold over here on that end.
See if we can pick it up.
You see they run the toss left. And you see it gets around the corner. And
yep.
Yep. There you see it. Good run. So you got to watch out. You get the penalties will kill you. And right now they're behind and they can't afford to have any penalties right now.
And that one looked to be called on Rodney Patterson, the left tackle. Sorry about that game watching party out in San Bernardino, but we got to tell it like it is. Penalty yards. First and 25. Line of scrimmage is now the 10-yard line. Williams with the handoff, and it is defensed well in the middle of the line. Nowhere to go for Pierre Brown. And Pierre Brown, who is from New Haven, Connecticut, we know that he has quite a few family members who are looking in at this broadcast this afternoon on ESPNU.
Well, these kids got to love it when they get a game nationally televised like this, and they're not from the immediate areas. And, you know, when I was in college, that was big, I went to Marshall, which is a smaller school, and sometimes when your game was on national TV, people all over the country could see you. And my That was definitely big for me playing in college.
on second and 25. Williams, he cannot get it. Well, he is able to throw that ball away, and he is not going to be ruled in the grasp. That is going to go as an incomplete pass.
You see that eight-man front is starting to get pressure on Fort Valley now that Fort Valley's not able to run the football, and they're going to have to try to pass it. So the thing is, the timing has to be right. If you've got that many men rushing the passer, you're not going to have all day to throw the football. And Williams found out the hard way on that play.
Darren Nettles, 99, had a hold of Williams. His dad, Ed, is a pastor at the Free Will Missionary Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. Third and 25. Now we've got whistles on the play, and we've got an official timeout on the field. And this timeout will go to Morehouse. So the Maroon Tigers have one timeout remaining in the first half. Log on to your online source for all things college sports, ESPNU.com. This online getaway will connect you to all the college sports content from ESPN. Log on to ESPNU.com today. We are college sports. Well, Coach Freeman, for Morehouse, got to be pretty happy with the way the game is progressing right now, Doug. They've been able to come up with some big plays offensively, and they've brought in the physicality so far to Fort Valley.
They have. They're playing their type of game. You know, physical smash mouth defense, opportunistic on offense. You know, they know that they're still trying to find themselves. They have a new quarterback in, Cook's out, Sterling's in, and the way they scored the touchdown is indicative of how they've gotten their points this year. It hasn't been traditional, but they bring the blitz, quarterback rolls out, stays alive. If that's what it takes to score points, their defense is going to keep them in football games. Their offense just has to put something on the board.
He's also going to be real happy with the way his defense is playing now, considering that one of his main defenders on that side of the football, Mario Lane, the senior from Montgomery, is suspended for the first half of this game. He'll be back in there, a fresh body on the defensive line for the second half.
And Fort Valley, if they can't move the ball in the first half, they're definitely going to have more problems in the second half when that young man gets back out on the football field.
Third and 25 from the 10-yard line for Fort Valley State. Lockett, who's got a touchdown catch to his credit already, is split out wide to the right. Brown is a wing to the left. Williams is going to roll left. And now he's going to tuck it. He's going to run it. He's got some room. Needs the corner. Cross the 25. Knocked out of bounds. Just shy of the marker. He needed to get to the 25-yard line. And it looks as if he's going to be about a yard shy.
And Morehouse, they only bring four. They drop everybody off in coverage. He looks downfield. No one's there. So what does he do? He tucks it and he runs. And he makes a good effort of it. Almost gets the first down.
And officially going to be marked out. Going to be marked out at the 25-yard line, 10 yards shy of the marker. So Grubbs is on to punt. This will be his third punt of the game. And Williams set to receive it. He's back at the 30. For Grubbs, that's his best punt of the day. Williams, no fair catch, and he paid for it.
You got to put your armor for that one, young fellow. You see those two blue shirts bearing down on you. They tell you when you're fielding a punt, you take that quick peek down. If those guys are big, that means they're close to you. If they're small, that means they're far away. Run it. But if he should have thrown his hand up on that one, luckily he didn't fumble the ball. He almost did.
Keon Montgomery, a reserve wide receiver, was there to deliver the hit. 43-yard punt, no return. And Sterling is going to stay in there at quarterback, and why not? He threw a touchdown pass on Morehouse's last possession, a 61-yard strike to Hinge. Out of the eye, this time they'll start on the ground. And there is just nowhere to go for the fullback, Pernez Pinckney.
Yeah, Pinckney had this tough sledding back there. Fort Valley is getting good penetration. The offensive line for Morehouse is not getting any surge off the football, and Fort Valley is in the backfield and brings Pinckney down for a loss.
So both these teams have had handoffs to their fullback here in the first quarter. And you can see Sterling receiving the play call from the sidelines. They'll go with four wide and a wing. Swing pass out of the backfield. Pass is caught. Lots of running room at that for Rodriguez, and he is knocked out of bounds near midfield. Flag is down. He's got the first down, but this one may be coming back.
If you can't run the football, sometimes throw a nice little swing pass to the receiver or a nice little screen. It's a big pickup, but maybe coming back if they have a penalty against Morehouse.
And it is a holding call. We do not have a referee's mic this afternoon. Can't pick up the player, but it is a hold.
See Sterling swings it out. A great play, great call. He gets out in space, uses his speed. Good blocking downfield, but a little too good blocking. You know, sometimes you got to get engaged with the guy. You feel him leaving you. Trust your runner. Let him make a move off of you. But sometimes you want to go too hard. You want to block too hard. And sometimes you get a little bit of jersey in there. Good effort, but the ref's going to call it every time.
McFadden got the call that time on the hold. It would have been a first down. And that is a first down carry, and they will pick up the first down. So after that swing pass to Rodriguez is called back on the holding penalty, he takes the handoff and picks it up.
It's like they're going with a little, you know, they're not going to try to power and run to the middle of that Fort Valley defense. They're going to try to spread the ball, spread the field out, and try to get on the corners, get their faster guys out in space. Maybe they might be more effective on offense that way.
Leon Murray is the offensive coordinator for the Maroon Tigers. Third down and short.
That's a movement in the offensive line.
It's third down and two. And this offside penalty against the Wildcat defense will give Morehouse a first down.
That was a break for Morehouse. Morehouse had some offensive line movement, but they may have already made
Let's
contact
go,
by the time they moved.
Gerald Cook started the game at quarterback for Morehouse, but he has given way to Christian Sterling, and so, you know, two quarterbacks, two different cadences. This could be the final play of the opening period. From the 46. Sterling, the protection is good. Kind of sidearms it out there. Pass is caught into Fort Valley territory. That's Henshey again. And Henshey is close to a first down. Maybe about a yard shy. Fort Valley 45. We've come to the end of the first period of play here in Georgia. Morehouse, losers of 10 consecutive games to Fort Valley State. They've got a 3-point lead at the end of our first period on the road. Maroon Tigers lead the Wildcats of Fort Valley State 10-7. You're watching college football out of the SIAC. Morehouse at Fort Valley State University. Get all your college football information on ESPNU Monday and Tuesday. First Monday at 7 Eastern, Lowell Galindo, Mike Gottfried, and Tom Luganbill deliver Inside the Polls, presented by 76. All season long, we'll break down the polls and dissect the hot topics of the day. Who's overrated? Who's underrated? Who deserves to be number one? Then Tuesday at 1 Eastern, Lowell Galindo hosts Coaches Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual. See and hear how a team's doing straight from the head coach as we bounce around coaches' press conferences from all around the country. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. We'll return right after these messages.
Bring your favorite team home with Glidden Team Colors Paint, the true colors of true fans. Today.
College football on ESPNU live this afternoon out of the SIAC Morehouse at Fort Valley State. We're in Fort Valley, Georgia for this one. I'm Dave Weekly along with Doug Chapman. We're early in the second. Morehouse, the road team in the white maroon uniforms, blue and gold, are the homestanding Wildcats of Fort Valley State. Fort Valley State trailing 10-7. They've got the football. They've rushed for only 21 yards thus far. Flag is down. And the Gator, Florida Gator transfer, Skylar Thornton cuts back to the middle of the formation. And I believe this one is going to come back. This will indeed go against Fort Valley.
When they shifted over, I'm not sure if everyone got reset in time before the snap, so it looks like they weren't set.
Now you got it, legal shift.
Yeah, you bring these two guys over on the opposite side, they have to get set first. Then you can snap the ball. He snapped the ball a little too quick. He didn't allow him to get set. Refs are going to see it. They're going to call it every time.
Four penalties for 25 yards here in the first half against Fort Valley. So on first and 15. From the 28. Single setback. And get a load of the defense by Morehouse. The middle of that line absolutely swallowed up the ball carrier. Gabriel Harper led the charge. Harper, the senior from Westlake High in Atlanta.
And you see, you know, with the way the Fort Valley can run the football, the type of running backs they have, Morehouse is looking for the run, and they've got eight guys in line of scrimmage, very active. Jeffrey Caldwell, and you see that defense get into the backfield, penetrate. It's going to be tough to run the football when you've got that many bodies on the line of scrimmage.
Thornton really hasn't been able to get anything going. That was his third carry. And here's Williams breaking out. Nice moves in the open field. One and two to make men miss. Across the 40, the 45, and steps out of bounds shy midfield. How about the moves in the open field by Garrett Williams, the senior transfer from Stockbridge, Georgia?
Hey, Garrett Williams is wearing number 10. He reminds me of another number 10 named Vince Young, the way he looked when he pulled that ball down and made some moves. He steps up, sees nothing there, and just pulls it down. Needs to put the ball away, does right there, and just makes a move. This is what you call, you can't coach this. This is athleticism. When you see a kid doing this, it's not something you can coach. When he pulls the ball down, there's nothing there. This is just him making a play right here. You like to see players do that sometimes if they have to.
Well, he just was able to get right around Earl Thomas, the middle linebacker, and once he did that, sidestepped Gabriel Harper. Nice gainer.
Come on, let's go!
All the way out to the 47-yard line. Here's Williams, good protection. Back across the middle, pass is caught.
And this is what they're going to have to do against Morehouse, is spread them out and throw the football. Don't let them clump around the line of scrimmage and try to run the ball right. There's too many bodies. Spread them out, make them play honest defense.
Here's Jarrell Hall.
Spread them out, make them play honest, and find the receiver downfield. Move the chains that way.
The Hall brothers, two of them, Chauncey and Jarrell. Our reserve tight ends for Fort Valley behind Elliott Williams and Jarrell the Jr. from Georgia makes the catch. And on first down, going to keep this one on the ground, going right up the middle. And running the football exclusively on this drive has been Skylar Thornton. And Thornton was everybody's All-American coming out of high school, Doug. Out of LaGrange, Georgia, Super Prep All-American. Ranked number 16 as a high school senior nationally as a running back. Got into the mix at Florida and transferred out looking for a place to play. Incomplete.
You know, sometimes a guy goes to a certain situation, and I'm sure Thornton has loads of talent, which we've seen, but the thing is that sometimes a guy may go to a situation where it's not ideal for him. Some of the best players in college sometimes aren't the best guy at that position. He just happens to be, he's in the right situation at the right time, he's healthy. And may learn, may be a coaching situation where he feels more comfortable with. But Skylar Thornton, loads of talent, and I'm sure Fort Valley is glad to have him here.
Oh, absolutely. That last pass was intended for Jarrell Hall again, and Hall at 6'3", 220, he's got good size. They can slide him out as a fourth wide receiver at times, and that time he did line up as a wide receiver. Here's Williams, play action, steps up again, throws, and flags are down. And that is going to go against Johnny Eubanks.
And you see the escapability of Garrett Williams. I mean, he steps up in the pocket. He should have been sacked three or four times this afternoon, where he steps up and is able to deliver a football, whether it's incomplete or complete. He's getting the ball out of his hands and downfield. And his legs are what's keeping these drives for Fort Valley going.
Pass interference against Morehouse.
You see him drop back, he scans the field, he steps up in the pocket, hangs in there, nothing's there. moves around in the pocket. That's what coaches love to see, is their quarterback moving in the pocket, but still looking to pass the football. Throws it downfield, pass interference. They don't get the catch, but they do get the change of move.
Morehouse, four penalties, 37 yards now. Running the option. Here's Thornton. Got the corner, 25, 20. Still on his feet, fighting for yards down near the 16-yard line. So Fort Valley State is in the red zone again.
Like I said with Garrett Williams, you have a quarterback that can move like that and cause problems in space. Get him on the option. You know, he reads it. His read comes. He pitches the ball to Thornton, picks up good yardage. And, you know, you have those two guys in the backfield. All you need is one crease for a guy like that, and he can take it the distance.
Hey, Doug, you got to appreciate. How about Maurice Dorsey, the fullback on that play, was able to block not one but two Morehouse defenders.
Okay, you got to love it when you see your guys out there working like that, especially as a running back. You'd love to see that.
Handoff inside. Give the ball to the up man. That's Brandon Anderson, his first carry. Sophomore for Warner Robins. He had a big game against Morehouse last year. Of course, his dad was a star for the Oakland Raiders and was a star here at Fort Valley State.
You see Fort Valley's trying to give Morehouse different looks now. They come out and line up in the power eye. They run the option. They run the spread. They put the quarterback back in shotgun, run the one back set. They're trying to keep Morehouse on their heels so they can't just tee off and keep blitzing on it.
Keon Montgomery is split out to the top of your screen. The flanker is on the left side. Now Williams shifts back into the gun. Quick shot to the 11-yard line, and the reception is made by Noah Wilmont. And Wilmont, the freshman from Jacksonville, Florida, has really become more and more a piece of their offensive arsenal since the start of fall camp. He has really been impressive.
Seems like more of a possession receiver, but you see if the cornerbacks from Morehouse are going to play off, if they're going to give you that cushion, have your receivers run a little short out route, short curl, dink and dunk down the football field. Doesn't matter how you get the yards as long as you get them.
Lockett, who's got a touchdown catch to his credit, comes into the lineup. He's at the bottom of your screen. Three wide again. Here's Williams. Steps in to the end zone. Wide open. Lockett's got two touchdowns here in the first half, and Fort Valley State's back in front.
And Lockett, he just abused the defensive back over there. He got a guy that's 6'3", the type of size he has, over 200 pounds. He's definitely a threat in the red zone to go up front of fade. But you see, he comes off the ball. He just abuses, turns the DB completely around. He's wide open. Could have made a sandwich in the back of the end zone while the ball got there. But, you know, a guy like that at the red zone is extremely dangerous. I played with a guy named Randy Moss in college and in the pros. And when you get down in that area, DBs, they really get nervous because you got that height and that amount of speed and can run routes like that. He's extremely dangerous.
Appreciate it, extra point up and good. Randy Moss, I wonder whatever happened to him.
He turned out pretty good.
Yeah, I think he did all right. 8:19 to go until halftime. We're starting to see some offensive fireworks, and that is something the folks who came out to this one like to see. 14-10, Fort Valley looking to make it 11 straight in the all-time series with Morehouse. They've got a four-point lead.
How you can get 3 weeks absolutely free.
Hey, strike up the band. Fort Valley State's back in front. It's 14-10, 8:19 to go before halftime. College football, and we are live, ladies and gentlemen, on a Sunday afternoon. 9 plays, 67 yards, 4.5 minutes. Lockett, a 12-yard touchdown reception, his second of the first half. He's got both TD passes from Garrett Williams. And now Jake Grubbs is set to kick off. Tywan McFadden is back to receive this kick. Dual safeties back there from Morehouse. And the ball goes off the tee. And folks, I got to believe it just fell off the tee. That was not the wind.
There's not a drop of wind out here. I haven't felt it. I don't know how that ball fell off the tee, but I don't think it got blown off.
Temperatures in the mid-90s for this one. Fort Valley, they love the hot weather, and Morehouse, they're dealing with it. Line drive kick. This is a returnable kick. And to the outside. Big yardage for Jamar Rodriguez. And I tell you what, when he gets in stride, he's like a track guy.
And Rodriguez does exactly what your coach should do on a kickoff return. They, kickoff return, they tell you to catch the ball on the run and just get north and south. He doesn't dance around. He finds a seam, hits it, gets upfield, picks up big yardage from Morehouse.
That's a 34-yard kickoff return. It's a good field position for Morehouse to start this drive. Morehouse stumbled a bit offensively out of the gate this afternoon, but they have played a little better offensively since the insertion of Christian Sterling at the quarterback spot. Now they'll run out of a one-back set. Going to keep this one on the ground. And a great hole on the left side, and shooting through goes Cameron Ford. They just cleaned it up over on the left side, Harwood and Reigns.
And you know it's a good run when the people tackling are your defensive backs and they're not at the line of scrimmage. This is a good off tackle, good blocking. And he gets out in space, gets upfield, moves the chains for a first down.
A big left tackle, Ramon Harwood, 6'8", 310. They call him a big mon from Barbados. Quick pass on first down to the 40-yard line for a gain of 7. Henge, who's got a touchdown reception for Morehouse, comes up with the catch.
And Morehouse's offense, like you said earlier, has been moving a lot smoother since the insertion of Sterling at quarterback. He seems to be able to make all the throws. He calls the correct audible at the line of scrimmage because they see they can't run the football on Fort Valley. They're nicked up at the running back position, so they're throwing it and throwing it well so far.
Here's the handoff. Let's go back to Christian Sterling, the junior from Texas, the former preferred walk-on from Texas Tech, who came in off the bench in relief of Cook early in this game. And you can see he's putting up the numbers. 4-6 for 93 yards and a touchdown. That was a 61-yard score to Henge late in the first quarter that gave Morehouse at the time a 10-7 lead. It's 14-10 right now, Fort Valley. Third down and 5 from the 40. Sterling again to throw. Across the middle, he's able to pick out his receiver. He's got the first down to the 29-yard line. The reception goes to James Stedman. And, you know, Stedman's a marked man out there. And they were able to finally get him in space and get him the ball.
That's a good throw by Sterling, but you have to give Cameron Ford credit for coming across the protection to pick up the blitzing defensive back to give Sterling just that extra second to deliver the football. And right now, Morehouse is putting together a very impressive drive.
Second team all-conference preseason makes the grab. From the 29, Sterling. Offensive line is giving him time to throw. Henge in the open field. Touchdown. That's going to be a 29-yard touchdown reception. His second of the first half. He's got two, and Morehouse goes back in front.
And Sterling and Henge look like they have great chemistry between the two of them. You know, I mean, this is like they're keeping the running back in to provide protection. The offensive line is giving Sterling time. And from what I've seen this afternoon, it looks like Mr. Sterling may be the quarterback that Morehouse is going to go with for the rest of the season. He's got a sharp arm, making a lot of throws, moves around the pocket well, sees the field well, and he's moving the chains, getting Morehouse touchdowns.
And the extra point is up and good. 17-14, back and forth we go. And so for Morehouse, this is the third time here in the first half they've gotten the lead.
You know, you see Sterling just drops back. You know, the running back steps up. Nice protection up front. He just finds open man downfield. You know, Fort Valley is dropping the defensive backs. Just Henge runs a good route, sits down in the open spot, finds the open soft spot in the zone, catches the ball, breaks some tackles, gets north and south, scores a touchdown.
College football action continues on ESPNU Thursday night as the Golden Eagles of Tennessee Tech face Southeast Missouri State, the Redhawks. College football primetime on ESPNU Thursday at 7:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. And of course, when you're talking about Tennessee Tech, you're talking about Watson Brown, former coach at UAB, and a long time ago, it's been years, 1969, when he was at Vanderbilt, led them to that big upset of Alabama. And Vanderbilt is off to a very impressive start in the early going, getting a win on ESPN earlier this week against South Carolina. They have not had a winning season, Doug, at Vanderbilt since 1982. They are off to a 2-0 start and looking good.
A lot of great players come out of that program. They just haven't had a lot of great teams. And plus competing at SEC, you know, you go against Florida's and Georgia and Tennessee's, you're going to, you know, it's tough sledding against those opponents.
Southeast Missouri State took on Mizzou this weekend, and Tennessee Tech lost to Louisville, but they will play each other, SEMO and Tennessee Tech, on ESPNU this week. 17-14, Morehouse with the lead, and the Maroon Tigers will kick off, and one of the up men grabs that ball. Dangerous play, but he takes it out to the 44-yard line.
I guess Morehouse decided they don't want to try to kick it to the deep men and risk a big return. They try to kick it to one of the up men. But good. Still, Fort Valley still ends up with good field position.
Good hands. Brandon McCrary, the junior tight end from Palmetto, Florida.
And he bobbles a little bit. He pulls it in and then just gets upfield. And that's all they ask the big fellas to do. They don't try to be fancy with it. Just catch the ball, get upfield, and don't drop it.
Well, we still got a long way to go in this one. Still over 6 minutes to play in our first half and an entire second half to come. We've talked quite a bit here in the first half about the extreme weather conditions, temperatures in the mid-90s. We anticipate that Fort Valley may handle the weather a little bit better. They're used to this weather. They practice in it. They've got the fans and the porta-cool. And we've got a timeout on the field. This one charged to Fort Valley. Right now the weather, 93 degrees, really no wind to speak of. You know, we were talking about, Doug, when you were doing conditioning when you were in the National Football League. What's this really like for a player?
I tell you, it gets to a point where you really only feel it when you first step out on the field. That first day of training camp, you really notice it. After about 2 or 3 days, it's just something you know in your head. It's more mental. You understand that the heat's not going anywhere. You have to practice, so you just have to get it done. And the same goes for when it's extremely cold. And I played in Minnesota for 4 years, and you know, we knew we'd go play the Green Bay Packers, the Chicago Bears outdoors. And I tell you, there's no need to even worry about it or be concerned. The weather's there. You have to just deal with the elements and prepare yourself mentally. Because once you start playing football, you forget about everything else anyway.
I want to follow up on that. But let's go ahead and take a look at the resume for Fort Valley State. Established 1895. There's your enrollment. Notable alumni, Rayfield Wright. Greg Lloyd, 5-time Pro Bowler with the Steelers. This university produces more African-American doctors and dentists than any other HBCU in the country. Great biology program, engineering as well. High academic standards. And Williams is dragged down. That will not go as a sack because he did get back to the line of scrimmage, but that was a good defensive play by Caleb Miller, freshman from Columbus, Georgia.
And Caleb Miller almost got the football out of the quarterback's hands on that play before he went for a strip. And you see Williams drops back, doesn't see anybody, and he's been using his legs all afternoon, so he tries it now, gets pulled down for a minimal gain.
Five-yard penalty against Morehouse. Now check that. You know, I think we got a face mask penalty. And this year, of course, every face mask penalty is a 15-yarder.
I don't like that. I like the horse collar rule. I do like that one, but sometimes, you know, it takes away from the aggression of a defensive player. If he just touches the face mask, doesn't even turn the head, just if he touches it and catches it a little bit, there, it should be a 5-yard, not a 15-yarder. It should be still a 15-yarder is when the head is turned, 5-yard is when you touch the face mask. I don't like that one.
On first down, able to swing that football out to the right side. And the reception is made by Darius Williams. The junior from Decatur makes the catch. There's another one of those plays, Doug, that you called an extended handoff. Let Williams make the play.
If you want to have a team that wants to stack and crowd the line of scrimmage, fine, let them. Get your receivers out in space. Just throw a nice little ball down short pass to him. Let him work, get down the field, move the chains.
Denzel Wesley is now into the game, and he's in there at the tailback spot and spins across the 30 down near the Morehouse 28.
And right now, Fort Valley's putting together a pretty good drive, going no huddle, hurry up offense, trying to catch Morehouse on their heels, try to hurry up and get 6 points on the board.
So now we've seen three tailbacks carry the ball here in the first half. Here's Wesley trying to get around the end. Able to get around one man, but Ty Huff sophomore linebacker from Atlanta tied him up and knocked him out of bounds. And
Ty Huff shows great lateral movement right there, running sideline to sideline with the running back, stays even with him and brings him down.
Well, Wesley's got some speed. 5'8", 180, a freshman from Macon. Boy, and on a day like this, you're going to need multiple backs.
You're going to need multiple everything. It's this high.
Williams from the gun. Wesley's is a wing to the left. Here's Williams in open space, throwing as a man down inside the 10-yard line, going to the end zone. That is a touchdown. Diego Dixon, the senior from Milledgeville, 27 yards on the score.
Hey, I tell you, you know, when you have a mobile quarterback, that's just that can also throw the football the way that Garrett Williams is throwing this football, and he can pull the ball down and move. This is a defensive coordinator's nightmare, right? They have him corralled. He just breaks down, breaks the pocket, keeps the play alive. It's called keeping the play alive. His receivers stay with him and looks downfield, finds an open man, and scores a touchdown. Most quarterbacks would have thrown this ball away or would have been sacked in the backfield. But when you have a quarterback that can move around and create things with his legs, it can cause problems for defenses all afternoon.
21-17, we've seen an awful lot of offense, kind of unexpectedly so here in the first half between these two teams. Fort Valley back in front by four. So here, Fort Valley State 21, Morehouse 17, 4:31 to go before halftime. Diego Dixon, Doug, with the touchdown catch, that's his first catch of the year. That's a great ratio. A 27-yard grab, his first grab of the year, and it puts Fort Valley back in front. You saw the scoring drive. And Jake Grubbs is going to kick off. Boy, these kickers are getting a workout today.
Yes, they are. I don't think they expected this many points to be put up, not in the first half, but hey, we're getting some offense out here today.
Grubbs, who's a senior, he was this conference's special team player of the week the first time he faced Morehouse back in 2005. He's having another good game today. High, relatively short kick. Ball dropped by Williams, and they're still having trouble getting on it, and they finally do back at the 11-yard line.
You know, Fort Valley comes out and they try what that's called a sky kick, where they kick the ball very, very high. Hopefully an up man catches the ball. What it does is it lets your kickoff team have time to run down and get down there in coverage instead of kicking a shorter kick. It's like a punt, actually, but hopefully sometimes you get a guy to muff it like that, and you know, you end up pinning them back, and they're in terrible field position. You see, he kicks and he panics a little bit. That happens if, when you're back there return man, you don't want to bobble that ball, and you know those guys are coming to that first bobble. When it happens, you start to panic. Sometimes they just tell you just fall on the ball and try to pick it up, and you know, luckily he got off the ground with the football.
How about Keon Williams, number 15 for Fort Valley? He's a real headhunter out there on special teams. He nearly knocked Williams away from that ball. He's had a couple of big hits here in the first half. Sterling's numbers, impressive. Off the bench, 7-9, 133, and two touchdowns. Both the Henshee for scores. A 61-yarder. And on the first down play, the ball rushed out of bounds by Christian Green. And here we go with one of these new rules. As he has run out of bounds, last year the clock would not start until the snap. Now when that ball is set for play, the clock will start again.
They're trying to pick up the pace of these games, but the only downfall to that is if you're a team that's down and you're behind in the fourth quarter, it makes it that much harder for you to come from behind with the clock working against you.
Now that new rule is not in effect in the final 2 minutes of the first half or the final 2 minutes of regulation. But you can see how it's shortening the game right there. Out pattern incomplete. Sterling just not on the same page with Stedman. I'll tell you what, I don't think there's too many Morehouse fans who would be watching this game saying, hey, they've got 17 points on the board on the road at Fort Valley with 4 minutes to go in the first half, and Stedman's really not been a factor. Oh, yeah. We anticipated that he was going to be a big part of their offense.
Hengji has been the go-to guy, but maybe you know, Stedman is probably, I'm sure, on the same page more with Cook, who Cook has been their regular starting guy. But Sterling seems to have found a rhythm on the kill Hengji.
Sterling, dangerous pass back across the green. Hengy makes the catch. And how about the yak? Yards after catch, he's got the first down and knocked out of bounds. A flag comes out. And this may be a shot to the helmet or horse collar.
It looks like it may have been either a high hit or a horse collar. I'm not sure, but we were just talking about Hengy, and Sterling and Hengy hook up one more time.
There you go. This is a horse collar call.
And there's the horse collar. You see this now. First off, this is a throw that will make a coach choke when he sees it. You do not throw the ball across the field, the middle of the field. And you see, I can't really see the horse collar. Maybe he was gang tackled on that sideline. You see, Hengy breaks a tackle, gets to the sideline, and there you see it. They're going to call it. They're looking for that, and they're going to call it every time now.
Pengel gets the call. First down carry. And I don't know how Christian Green got 5 yards out of that. He seemed to run about 1 foot off the ground for about the last 5 yards of that carry. That was a great run.
That's a great run. You know, this is the guy. He's playing with a harness on his shoulder that he hurt last week, and he's using that arm to keep himself balanced. He wants to get in there and make some plays, keeping your legs alive and just running the ball hard.
Injury on the field. That is Courtney Love, one of the safeties for Fort Valley. We're in Fort Valley, Georgia for college football on ESPNU live on a Sunday afternoon out of the SIAC. I'm Dave Weekly. Doug Chapman is here, and we are in the air-conditioned booth, which is a blessing today. 21-17. This one has gone back and forth. Right now, Fort Valley has got the lead, but Morehouse has the ball, and they are driving near midfield. You can see Morehouse, the road
play
team
ball,
in the white
man.
Maroon. Fort Valley, the home standing team in their familiar home blue uniforms trimmed in gold.
And make the play.
So Love will come out of the game, a sophomore from Doherty County in Albany, Georgia.
Man, you see right here comes from his safety spot and puts that arm down. When you get that arm outside the body, a lot of times it can be an AC joint, it can be a separation of the shoulder, but when you see him, well, it's good to see him walking off under his own power. When you see him holding that arm up, it's usually a shoulder injury or some type of upper arm injury.
Sterling throwing on the run. Pass is caught near the 44-yard line. Reception made by David Hart, junior from Allenhurst, Georgia.
Yeah, Sterling just has a live arm. He rolls out. He can stand in the pocket. He scans the field well, and he's been delivering the ball solidly this entire afternoon.
Look at those rushing yards. Just minimal rushing yards for Morehouse, but the passing yards. Morehouse with the edge there. Both teams virtually even in terms of first downs right now. First and 10 at the 44. Officially, we have Morehouse with one timeout remaining here in the first half as we turn under 3 minutes to play second quarter. Sterling on the play action going right down the seam, and that could have been six. Stedman had both hands on it. He was behind the defense, and that was a good play call by Morehouse because with one of your starting safeties out, suddenly they went deep.
And they went right at where the new guy was, you get the linebackers down, the play action gets the linebackers down into the line. You can't throw this ball any better considering the coverage. He puts it right where only his receiver can catch it. He just can't pull it in. Great ball. This is actually it's a great throw. Puts it right where only his receiver can get to it. He just can't pull it in.
You know, so many quarterbacks, Doug, are going to get excited in that situation and overthrow the receiver. Sterling just put that one right on the money. That was a great pass. Hart in motion. Sterling, he's got all kinds of pressure, and pass is intercepted. Picked off Reggie Hughes. You're not going to see too many interceptions made by a starting defensive end, but there's one. Reggie Hughes from Hepzibah High in Augusta, Georgia, with the big pick.
You know, they've been getting into the backfield and getting some pressure on Sterling, and finally they get the pressure to pay off. And you've got, you know, if you're active on defense and you never stop to keep your motor running, this is what can happen. And Sterling looks down the field, throws a ball he wishes he didn't throw. Ends up to the wrong color jersey, though.
Two and a half games for Fort Valley. That is their second interception of the year. Steven Bostic had an interception earlier this year, but how about that one? That's a big pick by Reggie Hughes. Now here with 2.5 minutes to go before halftime, Fort Valley can build on their lead. They're up 21-17. Ball is loose, flags are down. Motion. And it'll go against the Wildcats. Both coaches seem kind of unhappy. You know, we'd be remiss, Doug. We really haven't talked too much about the offensive coordinator for Fort Valley, one of your old coaches in college, Leon Perry.
Yes, he was. He actually, my redshirt freshman year at Marshall, he was the running back coach. He coached myself, another guy named Orlandis Gary. And before him and Coach Donnan went down to Georgia, he's a very good coach. I haven't seen him in a long time. I'm dating myself, but haven't seen him in a few years.
That is going to be ruled an incomplete pass. Dangerously close to a lateral.
And that was close. Luckily the quarterback was drifting backwards, because that was close to being a lateral. You know, they try to say that the rule goes if the pass is being thrown forward, but man, that was very, very close.
The officials right on the spot ruled that incomplete very quickly. And even though this game is nationally televised, NCAA Division II, there is no replay process. Williams giving ground. Going to throw this one into the stands. Incomplete. That was a smart throw.
It was a smart throw. And like I said, Garrett Williams does a lot of scrambling around back there, keeping plays alive, but more. That's an attribute to Morehouse's defense, that's getting in the backfield and getting pressure on him. You don't want your quarterback to always have to scramble. So that Morehouse is getting pressure, they just have to find a way to get Garrett Williams on the ground.
So now it is third and 15. We've seen some big third down conversions by Morehouse here in the first half. We'll see what Williams cooks up. Four wide. Sucking him in for the screen. And the pursuit is absolutely there for the Maroon Tigers. There's nowhere to go. Pierre Brown never had a chance. Defensive charge was led by Joshua Sumter, freshman from Fayetteville, Georgia.
And there's not many plays for third and long in an offense coordinator's playbook. They run the screen. Morehouse sits back. They're sitting in coverage, not letting anything get behind them. They see the play develop in front of them, come out and make the play, make Fort Valley punt.
Williams is back to receive this punt. Morehouse is going to call timeout, and we have them officially now out of timeouts here in the first half. Reggie Hughes with the interception, but Fort Valley unable to take advantage. Get all your college football information on ESPNU Monday and Tuesday. First Monday at 7 Eastern, Lowell Galindo, Mike Gottfried, and Tom Luganville deliver Inside the Polls, presented by 76. All season long, we'll break down the polls and dissect the hot topics of the day. Who's overrated? Who's underrated? Who deserves to be number one? Then Tuesday at 1 Eastern, Lowell Galindo hosts Coach's Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual. See and hear how a team is doing straight from the head coach as we bounce around coaches' press conferences from all around the country. More information, log on to ESPNU.com. And some of the band members having a tough time dealing with the heat. Of course, we're sitting up here close to the Fort Valley band, and we've heard them play quite a bit. And the Morehouse House of Funk marching band is also here as well, and they've gathered in the end zone to perform here at halftime.
Haven't seen one cramp on the field, though.
Not yet.
Usually you see that in this type of heat, but the band members are cramping up.
New punter in there that time. King was able to get that away. And he's all fired up about it. They did not send Grubbs out that time. Instead, they sent Marquette King, a freshman from Macon. And he did a good job. Now, we're not sure if there's a problem with Grubbs. We'll check that out. They may have just wanted to give Morehouse a little bit of a different look, because potentially in that situation, a fake was potentially possible. 90 seconds to go before halftime. And once we reach halftime, we'll have a talk with the president of Fort Valley State University, and he will tell us a story of a very, very unique plane ride with Demetri Young of the Washington Nationals that turned out to be very profitable for Fort Valley State University. We'll check all the scores from college football yesterday, because we can go down to the top 25. We'll have highlights and stats of our first two periods of play, a first half that has been filled with offense. Going to keep it on the ground, and Pernez Pinckney has been pretty busy carrying a football for Morehouse here in the first half.
Yeah, he has. With as beat up as the running backs have been for Morehouse, and then, you know, they weren't able to get anything done on the ground last week. You know, Pinckney's come in. He hasn't made it too many huge runs, but he's been solid inside, picking up positive yardage and helping keep them sustain Morehouse's drives.
Morehouse does not have a timeout, so they look to be fairly happy to just run the clock out and head back to the locker room trailing by four. Going to keep this one on the ground again and again. They go back to the fullback Pinckney, and Fort Valley is going to take this opportunity to call a timeout, stop the clock with 45 seconds left. And now Fort Valley State has one timeout remaining.
The Fort Valley is going to try to call a timeout, stop the clock, stop Morehouse, get them to punt. You know, the best case scenario for them would be to get a turnover right here, but they're going to try to get the ball back with decent field position and try and put some more points on the board before halftime if they can.
It's going to be third down and a long five. And I got to believe that Fort Valley is going to use that last timeout following this third down play to let that clock stop again. Because so many things are possible. A blocked punt, punt return. And I can imagine that these players are going to be so happy to get back to the locker room and get out of the sun for a little while.
You know, the way they have Morehouse backed up right here, the coach's strategy definitely is to, they want this ball back with as much time on the clock and as close to the end zone as possible.
Sterling under center. And they go back to the ground. And it is Pinckney. And as we anticipated, Fort Valley has burned their final timeout. So they've stopped the clock with 36 seconds left. They're out of timeouts. And now let's see what. All right, Doug, if you're a coach here, are you going to set up for the return, or are you going to go for the punt block here?
You know, I'm gonna probably come after this one here. I'm gonna go after it. You know, what's the worst that can happen? I'm gonna go after it. Even if we don't get to it, we get the ball back with halfway decent field position. And you never know. You never know with the way that Ricardo Lockett and Garrett Williams have been hooking up. You never know. They're one play away from scoring anywhere on the field.
Strife is back to punt it. Pierre Brown is back in punt formation for the first time today for Fort Valley, and he is at midfield. Both teams are out of timeouts.
We'll get them at halftime.
They go off this way.
Yeah, they're going to go right through the gate here.
Stripes kick will come from in the end zone. It's been a very offensive-minded first half. It'll be very interesting to see how the heat affects both these teams as we get a little deeper into this game. We think Fort Valley may have the edge, but who knows? Here comes a rush. Flags are down. Brown takes it from his own 49-yard line. He's into Morehouse territory. Needs a block. Trying to get to the outside. Inside the 40, 35. Knocked out of bounds. Good return, but now we'll have to check the flag. And this may be offsides against Fort Valley. No, now they're signaling it's going to be against Morehouse.
They get the return they wanted.
Yep.
You know, they get the ball, and they're going to get a couple extra yards tacked onto it with the penalty.
Motion against Morehouse. Now you've got the ball at the 35-yard line. Going to refuse that penalty and just take the ball? Yes. That's what Fort Valley's going to do.
No re-kick. Let's take this penalty here.
So you've got the ball at the 25-yard line. And take a couple of shots into the end zone. Yeah, you know, We're going to be talking to DeAndre Clark here in the middle, but I think the sweat is kind of wearing down the bow tie a little bit. Ricardo Lockett has a pair of touchdown catches in this game.
This is where a guy his size is very dangerous down here when the DBs don't have much behind him, and he can just climb the ladder, they'll get the football.
Williams inside the five, going to the end zone, touchdown! Rand. That catch is made by Skylar Thornton. He came out of the backfield, made the touchdown catch, but a flag is down. And a motion penalty is going to take that off the board. No! That's a penalty against Morehouse. The way Fort Valley was reacting, the penalty looked to be against Fort Valley. Instead, the penalty goes against Morehouse. 25-yard touchdown pass will stand. Skylar Thornton on the receiving end.
It ends up working perfectly to Fort Valley. They get the field position, get the ball they want it. One play, one touchdown. They get it right before half, and Skylar Thornton finds a soft spot in the zone, sit down, hooks up with Williams, turns, gets north and south, scores a touchdown.
So how about Garrett Williams with four touchdown passes in the first half?
No, he's having a big day. You know, you think of Fort Valley and the two running backs they have in Brown and Thornton. I think that they would primarily have moved the ball on the ground, but four passing touchdowns in the first half, I was not expecting this at all.
28-17, that is the largest lead for Fort Valley.
And you see everyone is looking at Ricardo Lockett, the big guy outside, and he runs as a decoy in, and Thornton just sneaks in, finds a soft spot, catches the ball, turns upfield, touchdown.
Boy, you know, that's the kind of thing that really gives a home team a little bit of extra boost in their step as they get ready to go off the field. That is a demoralizing touchdown to give up for Morehouse. They had played so much good football here in the first half, and now they find themselves down by 11.
Yeah, they were right in here in this game, down by four going into halftime, comfortable with going in and regrouping and coming out in the second half, and now they're down by 11. They gave up a touchdown in the last 25 seconds of the half, and hopefully those kids mentally can come out of the locker room and not let it demoralize them too much and play a better second half than they did the first.
All right, Grubbs is back in for the kickoff. He sends a roller down the field, and that ball appeared to be on its way out of bounds. Instead, it was picked up by Williams, and Williams brings it up the sideline right in front of the Fort Valley bench, and he's knocked out of bounds near the 35-yard line.
Good return. I mean, he was one toe away from stepping out of bounds, but he hung in there, caught the ball like it was heading out of bounds. It turns upfield and it gets a good return out of it.
Now that ball is going out of bounds. And Doug, one of the new rule changes in college football this year is if a ball goes out of bounds, the receiving team has the option of taking it at the 40-yard line.
Right.
So Morehouse should have probably let that ball go and they would have had five more yards. But that's tough when you're on the field and you're trying to figure out where you are and you're trying to field that ball. Nevertheless, that's one of the new rule changes to put more emphasis on kickers keeping the ball in bounds. And we have come to the end of our first half.
It's time to turn a small budget into a big difference. It's time to try something new. It's time to .com.
Live college football on ESPNU this afternoon, Sunday afternoon edition out of the SIAC, where Fort Valley leads Morehouse College 28-17. Both our bands have performed and have started to move off the field. Fort Valley has come back out, and we anticipate we'll see Morehouse in just a moment. We hope to get a comment from Rich Freeman, their head coach, when they return to the field. College football action continues on ESPNU Thursday night, as the Golden Eagles at Tennessee Tech face the Red Hawks of Southeast Missouri State. College football primetime on ESPNU Thursday at 7:30 Eastern. For more, log on to ESPNU.com. All right, we were talking at the end of the first half, Doug, about some of the rule changes in college football. And we've seen a couple of rule changes already in this game. We saw a horse collar call and, of course, the new rules in terms of the play clock, where college football in every division, not Division One and Division Two, but every division has basically gone to the 40-25 model the NFL uses, where the 42nd play clock starts once a play is ruled down. Now, after penalties and other administrative stoppages, we go back to the old 25-second clock. But I think everybody's kind of getting adjusted to this. And the point of this is to save time and to get college football games down to around the same elapsed time, total elapsed time, as the NFL, which is about 3 hours. And in the first couple of weeks, we're seeing college football games, which last year averaged about 3 hours and 22 minutes, down to about 3:10. What do you think of that rule?
I think it's a, you know, it's with every rule, it's always two sides to it. If you're the team that's down and you're trying to come back, that rule can sometimes go against you. If you're the team that's up late in the game and a team with a pretty powerful offense is trying to move the ball, it can go in your favor. But I do like how they're trying to get the speed of the game up, the tempo of the game up. So I think that's a pretty good rule.
Rich Freeman, the head football coach at Morehouse, joins us now before the second half. And Coach Freeman, what's your plan for the second half to try to come back against Ford Valley on the road?
Well, one of the things we're noticing, they're a football team that can score extremely fast. You know, we got to try to find some type of way to get control of this football game. We've been having problems with personnel exchange, you know, exchanging from offense to punt team and from defense to punt return. We've been having problems with personnel having 11 people on the field. So, you know, my charge to the coaches was that we remedy that extremely fast and, you know, make sure that our personnel change is up to par.
Coach Freeman, appreciate it. Go coach him up in the second half. Best of luck.
Yes, sir. Thanks.
All right, Rich Freeman, he's done a very good job at Morehouse turning that program around. But right now, his team is looking at a deficit of 28-17 as we get set to begin our third quarter of play. And by the way, we do appreciate him spending a couple of moments live right before the start of the third quarter.
Sun is gone in a little bit. Provide a little bit of relief for these players and coaches out there.
It'll be back.
Oh, yeah.
It'll be back. Morehouse won the toss and deferred to the second half. So the Maroon Tigers will get the ball back. And they will have the football first as we begin our second half. Morehouse is 0-1 on the season. Ford Valley State is 1-1. Ford Valley State lost their season opener 56-3 at Valdosta in a game that really wasn't that competitive. First four snaps of that game went for Valdosta touchdowns. And they were down 21-0 in the first 7 minutes, and they trailed 35-3 at the break. Last week, Fort Valley State much more competitive. In fact, they won, beat Clark Atlanta. Clark Atlanta, of course, is the arch rival of Morehouse. Short kick, and that one is going to get on the ground. Going to have to chase that ball all the way back to the 9-yard line. And Jamar Rodriguez is knocked out of bounds near the 25. All right, let's go ahead and check our first half stats. 191 passing yards in the first half for Morehouse. However, the Maroon Tigers continue to still have trouble moving the ball along the ground. Penalties, I think both coaches would agree, too many penalties in the first half. And despite all this heat and despite this game being played so early in the season, just one combined turnover.
Yeah, a lot of times the heat can contribute to mental mistakes made by players. But like I said, I haven't seen too many guys go down with either cramps or make mistakes due to the heat. But we still have another second half of football to play.
Christian Sterling in at quarterback for Morehouse. And they'll put it up on first down, or they wanted to put it up. And now Sterling will run. And Sterling reaches the 30-yard line before he is brought down.
And they send three receivers vertical on that play. Sterling just didn't have anyone to throw to. They were all covered well. He pulls the ball down and runs, but he needs to get down a little more or learn to slide. Cook is banged up with ribs, and Sterling's going to be banged up with some ribs if he keeps taking shots like that.
Bernard Goodrum, the middle linebacker, with a hard hit. Picked up 8 yards. It's second down and two from the 30-yard line. You're talking about the clouds here, Doug. I think this is the most cloud cover we've seen here maybe in 2 days since we've been here. And that's a break for these players. Extremely long first half. Boy, stepping into the hole is Trenton Newton. And he makes the big hit on Cameron Ford, the ball carrier. Newton had quite a first half, had two big sacks. He's a leading tackler for Fort Valley State.
And though Morehouse had success in the first half passing the ball, you know, you have to keep the defense honest. You have to attempt to run the football so that you can set up your play action and your other passing plays. So they're trying it, but Fort Valley's there to make the stuff, and not much going there.
Did pick up the first down. That was a hard-earned 2 yards. First and 10 from the 31. Play action fake, swing pass. Williams has it, and that ball is... Did they rule that ball as a fumble? I'll have to wait and see where the ball is set. Yes, that was a completed pass and ruled a fumble. Here's another look.
Yeah, he has possession of it and puts it on the ground, yes.
Boy, what a lucky bounce. Luckily, came right back to him.
Luckily gets it back.
So now it's second down and 14. Love with the big hit. Nearly caused the turnover. And now we've got a change of quarterback. Cook is back in. And Cook on the carry. Across the 30. And Doug, you may have been right. It may have been that big hit by Trenton Newton on Christian Sterling that may have knocked him out of the game momentarily, because Gerald Cook, the junior from Pleasant Grove, Alabama, who started the game, is now back in. And now he will exit. And Christian Sterling comes back in.
You know, they already have enough guys nicked up at the running back position. Now both of their quarterbacks are a little nicked up. They're having all type of problems with injuries on offense today.
Third down and 7. Trips to the bottom of your screen to the right. Protection is good. Right down the seam. Intercepted. Second interception of the day. This one, Bernard Goodrum. And Goodrum is heading to the house. Touchdown, Fort Valley State. A 46-yard interception return. Second pick of the day. This one goes to the house for the Wildcats.
And I'm not sure about that hit. Sterling took a few plays back, but he may be a little rattled. He comes out and came out for a play. Cook comes into the game, and Sterling comes right back in. When he drops back, decent protection. He sees the field and just, I mean, he just makes a poor throw. Throws it to the wrong color jersey. Bernard Goodrum just sitting back playing zone, checking his man. Ball comes right to him. He turns it up north and south, gets into the end zone. Big play for Fort Valley.
Extra point is up and good. 35-17 early here in the third quarter.
Huddle up every football weekend with ESPN News.
Remember, behave yourselves.
You're watching college football out of the SIAC Morehouse at Fort Valley State University. Get all your college football information on ESPNU Monday and Tuesday. First Monday at 7 Eastern, Lowell Galindo, Mike Gottfried, and Tom Luganbill deliver Inside the Polls, presented by 76. All season long, we'll break down the polls and dissect the hot topics of the day. Who's overrated? Who's underrated? Who deserves to be number one? Then Tuesday at 1 Eastern, Lowell Galindo hosts Coaches Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual. See and hear how a team's doing straight from the head coach as we bounce around coaches' press conferences from all around the country. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. We'll return right after these messages.
So here we are in the fourth quarter. No time left, and the touchdown is under review.
Hey, guys, what do you think?
We're not ready to go yet.
Do you know game day? Go to collegegameday.com to find out. ESPN College Game Day, built by the Home Depot. Saturdays at 10 a.m.
35-24, Fort Valley leads Morehouse. Morehouse got a little closer with a touchdown just moments ago. Still 8:25 to go in our third quarter. And Doug, we don't mean to emphasize this nearly enough, but the heat has been a major factor. 35-24, Fort Valley leads Morehouse. Morehouse got a little closer with a touchdown just moments ago. Still 8:25 to go in our third quarter. And Doug, we don't mean to emphasize this nearly enough, but the heat has been a major factor today, not just for the players, but for many of the fans in the stands who have arrived early. EMS has been very busy. A little bit of a dangerous situation today as our temperatures remain in the mid-90s for this one. On the kickoff return, Dorian Giles. Giles had a 100-yard kickoff return for a touchdown on the opening kickoff called back today. College football action continues on ESPNU Thursday night as Tennessee Tech, the Golden Eagles, face Southeast Missouri State, the Red Hawks. College Football Primetime on ESPNU Thursday at 7:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. And we pointed out there is a portico station behind the Fort Valley bench, but there is nothing on the Morehead or Morehouse sideline. No fans, nothing.
I guess that's what you get when you're the home team. You know, you get the nice fans and the porticos, and when you're the visitor, you get nothing. Some cool water.
And Williams, who tossed four touchdown passes in the first half, did not like the setup there and calls a timeout. First timeout of the first half.
Down with.
For the Wildcats.
I'm looking to see if Garrett Williams and company can pick up where they left off in the first half with that passing attack, or if Morehouse has made some adjustments at halftime, maybe pulling some of those guys off that eight-man front.
Doug, let me ask you about something we teased at halftime. We were talking about the scores from the top 25. Maybe the most controversial play in college football this weekend came at the end of the BYU-Washington game, where the Huskies quarterback Jake Locker directed a tremendous last-second drive for an apparent game-tying touchdown. He was called for unsportsmanlike conduct when he threw the ball up over his shoulder after the touchdown. 15-yard penalty. BYU blocked that extra point. We'll get to that in a second. But on the first down play following the timeout, Fort Valley State saw something they liked, because Kyle Oden, his first carry, the sophomore from Atlanta, takes it nearly out to half midfield.
And you see right here, nothing fancy, just straight up the middle like a trap block. And he just gets north and south, gets into the secondary. A big run. Fresh legs.
First and 10. Williams, protection's good. He throws a nice tight ball to the 48-yard line. And the reception is made by Darius Williams. We're in Fort Valley, Georgia for SIAC College Football Live on ESPNU on a Sunday afternoon. I'm Dave Weekly with Doug Chapman. 28-17, Fort Valley had the lead at halftime, but now here in the second half, it's 35-24. Morehouse scored on their last possession. Second and a long six. Williams swings it out. Pass is caught by Oden, who brings it back to the middle of the field. And he is going to be brought down shy of the 45-yard line, brought down at the Morehouse 46. It'll be third down and three. What your take on that penalty on Locker at the end of that Washington BYU game? What do you think?
I think it was an awful call. If you didn't see the game, he kind of just he scores a touchdown that puts his team in position to win a football game. And he just flicks the ball straight up in there, not at anyone. His teammates come and they celebrate with him. And they threw a flag, which caused him to have to kick an extra long, extra point. This block, a referee should never, ever control the outcome of a football game. And his call totally affected the outcome of that game.
I want to get one more comment about this from you in a moment. But meanwhile, back to our game, Fort Valley State. Again, it's Oden, and he is dropped in the backfield. Morehouse, I think for a moment, thought they had a fumble recovery, but no fumble lost, simply a stop on the carry. It is fourth down. And the punt team is not coming on. Fourth down and four. You know, the last time these teams met last season, Fort Valley was 4 of 5 on fourth down. I asked DeAndre Clark about that yesterday, and he said they just want to keep the football. They're willing to roll the dice. They just want to keep possession at all costs. And now Fort Valley's going to have to call a timeout. So now the Wildcats only have one timeout remaining for the remainder of regulation.
Now they're up by 11. It's the third quarter, and they only have one timeout left. Hopefully that does not come back to haunt them if Morehouse makes a run towards the end of the football game.
Timeout Fort Valley will take it with them. 35-24, Fort Valley State.
Is a lamp unto my
There are songs that speak to our hearts and bring us hope.
Butterfly kisses after bedtime prayer.
Time Life presents I Can Only Imagine, the greatest power anthems of the Christian faith.
I can only imagine.
And now, the I Can Only Imagine collection is bigger and better than ever. Presenting I Can Only Imagine Platinum. 22 songs on two CDs.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Plus, you'll also get an exclusive bonus CD, including this special version of I Can Only Imagine.
Surrounded by your glory, one will my heart feel.
Call now to get I Can Only Imagine Platinum. Now on three CDs for just
$19.99.
Wait, call in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll cut the price to just
$9.99. God is in control.
That's three CDs, 30 powerful Christian anthems for just
$9.99.
Then review other inspiration.
After the timeout by Fort Valley State, taking a look at this fourth down and three situation. Now the punt team is coming back out. So Williams on the offense will stay on the sidelines. The punt team comes back out. And for the second time today, Grubbs will not punt. Instead, Marquette King will kick it away. There is no one back for Morehouse. And it's a short kick. Not a very good kick at all. And we'll see where this ball is set for play. Got a 12-yard punt.
Yeah, I doubt if that's what they were going for on that.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think they were going for that.
Quarterback comparison. Sterling's last interception, the second of his two, was returned for a touchdown. Williams has been much more efficient. 142 passing yards, four touchdown throws, and he's run for 37 yards. So Morehouse scored a touchdown to get a little closer the last time they had the football, and now they got it back. And you know Christian Green is hurting with that shoulder injury, but he is still hard to bring down.
He sees his team needs him, and I guess he figures as long as his legs still work, he'll get there and give him whatever he has.
DeAndre Clark has lost the jacket for the remainder of the day. Play ball. But he's still sporting this bow tie.
Give it left on the tackle. Let's go.
Gain of two, second and eight. Here's Sterling. In traffic, and this one's going to be picked, his third of the day. Interception by Darnell Burke, sophomore from Cutworth, Georgia. And he just threw that one into all kinds of traffic.
And this is the second poor throw he's made this half, and he just drops back. And he just puts this ball up for anybody. There's three blue shirts back there. He just throws the ball up. Donald Burks gets underneath it. I'm not sure what he was reading. He was trying to go to his receiver, and he didn't have anything on the ball and puts it up. And Fort Valley State has the ball again.
And suddenly nobody's thinking about that 12-yard punt. Cheka, the turnovers have been the undoing of Morehouse to this point, although it's still an 11-point game, and this has been a high-scoring affair. Third turnover for Morehouse. Three interceptions, all by Sterling. Here's Williams, still looking to throw. Rolls out of the pocket, throws on the run. Incomplete. And he was trying to rifle that one to Darius Williams.
The fact that he was even able to escape harm's way just shows, his escapability. We need to find out if Garrett Williams is related to Juice Williams, the way he's, I mean, he drops back and, I mean, look, you see him, he looks around guys, they have their hands on him, he still scan the field, and is able to get this ball away. He just, he's working magic back there, not getting, avoiding the sack.
So Garrett Williams, very interesting story. He started at Savannah State, set completion and attempt single season records there. When they had a change of coaches, he decided to take a look at a couple of different schools and landed here at Fort Valley. Now they run the option. Oh, and Skylar Thornton never really got rolling. And that was a good open field tackle by Randall Ward.
And that's a way to play the option for Morehouse. You know, you have the pitch man, and then your DBs come up and make a play, getting off of a block and making a great play, getting Thornton down before he can get started.
Talk about your one-on-one. Thornton number one, dropped by Ward number one, and that was a very good open field tackle before he could get to the corner. Third and 10. Four wide receivers. Lockett, who's got two touchdowns to the bottom of the screen, top trips to the top. Here's Williams right down the seam, incomplete. That pass was intended for Lockett, and Lockett's having a little bit of difficulty, and I think he's got a cramp in that left leg.
Hopefully that's all it is. You see Williams goes in, Lockett's in double coverage, almost brings this one in.
Had both hands on it.
Steps in, good throw. I mean, puts it on his receiver. Just great coverage by the defensive backs, but hopefully Lockett just got a cramp towards the end of that play.
It's a second good defensive play in a row by Randall Ward, the junior from Detroit. And they are working on that left leg of Lockett. Grubbs back into punt. Flag is down. High, short kick. Take a Fort Valley roll down to the 15-yard line. 23-yard punt inside the 20. We'll have to wait and see what the flag's all about. Rod Galloway is our referee today.
There's been a lot of penalties in this football game.
All right, procedure penalty, and Morehouse is going to accept that and force Fort Valley to kick again. This will be his fourth of the day. Nearly blocked. And this one goes sailing out of bounds. And looks like it's going to be a pretty good decision by Morehouse. Force them to kick again. And that is going to be marked out near the 30-yard line at the 29. So with 3:03 to go in our third quarter, Morehouse trails by double digits, but they are far from out of this one. It's 35-24. 14-yard punt.
Jack Link's Beef Jerky presents Messing with Sasquatch. Jack Link's Jerky. Feed your wild side.
Hi,
You're watching college football out of the SIAC, Morehouse at Fort Valley State University. Due to time constraints, we're moving ahead in our action. Set to start the fourth quarter, Fort Valley State leads at home over Morehouse 35-24. Fort Valley has beaten Morehouse 10 consecutive years. Morehouse with a touchdown here, be right back in the ballgame. Pass is tipped, incomplete, intended for Stedman.
And he had Stedman on the slant. You know, that big body was going to keep working him and going to him. You know, you see Sterling, he drops back, takes one step, lets the ball go. Ball is good, great play. Great play.
Trenton Newton.
Newton by getting in the hole and knocking that ball away.
Newton has really been doing a good job. As we begin our fourth quarter, here's Morehouse on this drive. 10th play of it coming up. They've controlled the ball for over 3 minutes. Total yards today, Morehouse leads Fort Valley 349 yards to 222. It's been the three turnovers that have really been the difference.
Yeah, turnovers will kill you. I mean, you can have all the yards in the world, but, you know, one of those turnovers led to 6 points directly, so that'll hurt you.
Sterling with the pass. It's caught. But Steven Bostic was right there to make a short tackle on David Hart, and it is fourth down. Now, this is an 11-point lead.
And you see right here, he finds him, and he had, in the back of the end zone, if he'd have just been a little more patient, he had Hingy wide open in the back of the end zone, and Hingy wanted that football. Do it to David Hart. David Hart just dropped short of the end zone.
It's fourth and goal at the 5-yard line. And Strife is coming on for the field goal attempt. This will be a 20-yard attempt. It'll come from the left hash. David Hart is the holder. High snap. Kicks up and good. 14:05 to go. Strife with a 20-yard field goal. It's 35-27. Look at that. Last week against Benedict, you see the total yards, just 3 yards rushing. They give up 5 sacks in that game. In college football, sacks go against rushing yards. Today, Morehouse, however, nearly 350 yards of total offense, and they rushed the ball a little better, 64 yards.
Yeah, when we spoke with Coach this week, he was very upset with the way they played. He said that they didn't play like they were prepared, and they underachieved, but he knew his team could play better. They definitely come out offensively and got something going and moved the ball. Now they just have to find a way to stop Fort Valley from scoring, get the ball back in decent field position and put some points on the board.
Yeah, they were really frustrated in that game with Benedict. They led that game 3-0 at the half. In the second half, they had a first and goal at the 5-yard line and ended up punting after having 4 straight penalties. Then in the fourth quarter, they had a first down at the Benedict 11 and ended up missing a 30-yard field goal. Lost that game 7-3. Coming back the other way on the kickoff return to the 28-yard line goes Denzel Wesley, the freshman. Special teams tackle made by Harry Telfair. We're in Fort Valley, Georgia. College football live this afternoon. We are all the way live on ESPNU. From Wildcat Stadium, I'm Dave Weekly. Happy to be alongside Doug Chapman here in the press box, which is air-conditioned. Unfortunately, that is not the case for the majority of the fans and the teams on the field. It's been brutally hot all day long. Temperatures in the mid-90s. And look at that. The uniforms have come off the band. We've had some band members suffer some heat exhaustion today. And on first down, the defense for Morehouse starting to come on a little bit. Jeffrey Carguy.
We haven't heard his name much in this game. You know, he's a big-time player coming in. He gets back there. He's very, very busy on the line of scrimmage, gets in the backfield, makes a big tackle for a loss. He had 3 of those last week.
So Carguy from Cincy St. X told a great story earlier this week about the fact he didn't know where he was going to go to school, and he told his parents in Cincinnati on a Friday that he was going to go to Morehouse, and school started the following Wednesday. Williams, the flip out of the backfield, broken tackle, first down. Pierre Brown, one of a bevy of backs we've seen used today by Fort Valley State.
They've gone with a bevy of backs, but none have really been able to get anything going. And that's the thing at running back and at quarterback. You know, you can have a 2 running back system or a 2 quarterback system, but really one guy is not going to be more effective unless he gets into a groove. And running back's one of those positions where you get 1 yard here, 1 yard here, then you break a long one. But when you're rotating backs in and out, it's very hard for a running back to get into a groove and a rhythm.
Well, DeAndre Clark, who's the head coach and the athletic director here at Fort Valley State, likes to use some of the track athletes, including Pierre Brown on the football team. Here's Williams throwing on the run, and the catch is made up at the 44-yard line. That was a tough grab. And it was Ricardo Lockett who's got a couple of touchdown catches today. Lockett was the SIAC newcomer of the week last week after he put up 191 all-purpose yards in a win over Clark Atlanta, and he's continued to produce today. But Brown qualified last year for the NCAA Division II Outdoor Track and Field Championships as a decathlon competitor. He's a great athlete. Williams, pass tip, dangerous, and then nearly caught.
You see Mario Lane is back on the field for Morehouse now, and he's raising some havoc in the middle of that line of scrimmage. Actually tips that football. He gets back. He was suspended for the first half. He's playing now, and he gets in and makes an immediate impact.
Yeah, Lane, number 56, a senior from Montgomery, Alabama, Carver High School, did not play in the first half. He was suspended after getting in a fight last week in the Benedict game. At one time was a highly regarded prospect, originally committed to Alabama. He sat out for 2 years, didn't play for 2 years, trying to get his transfer in order to get to Morehouse, and is still considered one of the best small college defensive prospects for next year's draft. Williams on the carry slides down shy of the marker, but in Morehouse territory near the 48.
And Garrett Williams, once again, is dangerous with his legs, and he's seen those hits that Cook and Sterling have taken all game, and wisely slides down instead of leading with his head. But, you know, right now, if they need to get a spy from Morehouse or something to keep an eye on him, because little runs like that are what's going to keep Fort Valley's offense on the field. Morehouse and Morehouse's offense off of the field. Morehouse can't score points if their offense is not there.
Third down and two. On the carry, can't do it. Unable to turn the corner, the stop is made. It's that man again, Cargyle. And so Fort Valley's going to have to punt the football.
You know, you look at Cargyle, if you look at him, and he's very undersized for a linebacker position, but he's so active and hard to block. He shoots through gaps very well, and he's very tough, and he gets in and he makes a big stop right here and forces Fort Valley to punt. We haven't called his name, but he makes a big play when his team needs it.
Grubbs. Oh, this is a good punt. Great punt. Drives the receiver, who makes the catch all the way back at the 2 yard line. What a huge air, and is going to be down near the three. And that was a huge air on special teams by Tyderick Williams. That was a 56 yard punt, a return of 2 yards. He fielded that punt at the 2 yard line.
I think Williams may have lost where he was on the field. It happens a lot. A player will backpedal for an extremely long punt. He'll forget where his feet are, and you know, the rule is once it goes inside that 10, let it drop. And he caught it and was lucky to get out of the end zone and not have a safety for his team.
Now this is a face mask penalty pending against Morehouse. Now check it. Now they've called a face mask penalty against Fort Valley. So this will be marked off after the kick. So it'll be interesting to see how this one's going to be marked. I think our referee just, and this is going to be a tough day on the officials as well out there in the sun. He may have just simply pointed the wrong way initially.
Keep those refs hydrated. You see this punt right here. He loses himself on the field, and I'm sure he was in panic mode knowing his feet were in that end zone, and he gets up and avoids the safety.
So the penalty moves the ball out to the 19-yard line, and that is where Morehouse will have it when we come back. 35-27, early in the fourth.
70.
35-27, 5:39 to go here in our fourth quarter. This has been a very entertaining game. We expected a defensive struggle. We did not get that. We got offensive fireworks virtually from the word go, but how about some fine defense there? Sterling is brought down. Pengel fires through from the middle of the defensive line and gets the sack.
And the offensive line, I'm telling you, is they're having some issues up front protecting the quarterback and getting seams for the running back, and this is evident right here. I mean, they just let him through, and Sterling has nothing but blue shirts in front of him when he looks down the field to pass.
Well, Cameron Ford tried to pick him up, and he just flicked him off like a bug and went right to the quarterback and sacked him.
Someone needs to tell Mr. Ford that you can cut these big guys when they're coming free. Like, you do not try to block them high.
So it's second down and 20. Morehouse needs to reach their own 41 for the first down. Stepping up, thrown into the middle of the field. That was a dangerous pass. He's thrown a couple of those today, and that one is caught. Taiwan McFadden, sophomore from Miami, makes the grab.
You know, if you're Fort Valley, I'm sure you have your eye on Henge and Stedman right now. So someone, like I said, another receiver has to step up. That may be McFadden on this drive, and you see Sterling drifting to his right, throws across his body to the middle of the field. A very dangerous throw, but I guess he said we're down. There's 4 minutes left. You have to make something happen. Luckily, it worked out for him.
McFadden from Northwestern High School in Miami, a sophomore. Many of his former high school teammates played last night for the Miami Hurricanes in that big ESPN primetime game against the Gators in the Swamp. Pass is caught and they pick up the first down. It's Henge breaking tackles, taking it into Fort Valley territory. One of the biggest plays of the game, potentially, all the way down to the Fort Valley 40.
Shield Henge has been playing big this entire afternoon. We haven't heard his name in a few series because Fort Valley's been kind of keeping an eye on him, but he gets free right here and short pass, and this is what he's been doing all afternoon, breaking tackles.
Two.
Coming across the field and
three, four.
It finally goes down after a big game, but you know he's had a huge afternoon.
And this is bad news for Fort Valley as Trenton Newton, who's had a tremendous game defensively for Fort Valley, is now down and needing medical attention. Here's Henge, 8 catches, 2 TDs, 172 yards receiving today.
They're going to know his name when he leaves today. They may have problems for announcing it when he first got here, but they're going to know who a Shield Henge is after this game.
Trenton Newton, the junior from Lakeland, now getting back up on his feet. Watch 21 on the replay. Boy, he nearly knocked that ball out of there.
He's got a little shaken up. A lot of collisions going on down there. He's got a tad shaken up in that play. Hopefully it's nothing too serious.
Well, Morehouse only has one timeout left, so that may impact the way their strategy here at the end of this game. This may be the drive. They trail by 8. Handoff inside. And Cameron Ford gets the carry. Takes it down to the 36-yard line. So it'll be second down, and the clock continues to run.
Yeah, you know, Morehouse in a situation now where they've got a score and they have to go for 2. So there's no debating. They've got to figure out how they're going to get to the end zone. And hopefully they've got a good 2-point conversion play drawn up already.
Rich Freeman, head coach at Morehouse. It's been a good coaches matchup today. .380 of total offense. Throw over the middle, wide open. Inside the 10, inside the 5, to the end zone. Stretching for the pylon. Give him the touchdown. Quincy Avery. Well, clutch, catch, and run. Takes it to the house, fighting the final 5 for the 6. 37 yards on the score. And now a 2-point attempt, most likely coming here to tie the game.
And you see Fort Valley, they run a nice little stunt up front, get some penetration to the backfield, and wide open. He runs, makes some nifty moves, and gets down to the 1-yard line, stretches that ball across, gets as long as it's inside of that pylon. You break that plane, that's 6 points. And he gets in there, takes a big shot. Good job.
All right, 2-point attempt coming here. Gotta wonder if this might be the place you might want to burn your final timeout.
You know, some coaches, what they'll do is they'll have 2 plays called here. When you come out, you're lined up. If you're lined up in the defense, if they want you, and they'll run it. If not, they'll go to an audible. Let's see what they do here.
Sterling on the rollout, looking to the end zone. Pass is caught, 2 points. And who else? Henge. And we are all tied at 35. All with 2:43 to go. Morehouse has been climbing the mountain most of the day, and now they've tied the game at 35.
don't know. Maybe you should have been the blonde.
Maybe you should just listen to the game.
Maybe if you shaved your legs like me, the sneak in would have worked.
Maybe if you hadn't lost our season tickets in a lawsuit because you got cheapo insurance, we'd be inside the stadium watching the game dressed like men. Huh?
I don't want to get into this she said thing.
Getting cut-rate insurance to save a little money could end up costing a lot. Call an Allstate agent today for a free Good Hands coverage checkup. Are you in good hands?
It's Fan Friday, NFL fans. Our day to prepare for overtimes, Hail Marys, touchdown dances, and underdog victories. We'll stand up as a group or stand out in a crowd. On Fan Friday, we flaunt our allegiance and wear our team out. Get your official Reebok NFL apparel at Dick's Sporting Goods.
You've done your research.
We went on cars.com, we compared models side by side, and I didn't have to resort to Plan B.
What's Plan B?
I was gonna have you eat these brownies, which I mixed with a horse laxative.
Excuse me.
My husband kind of has a sweet tooth.
It's College Football Saturday on ESPNU. First, Navy heads to Blue Devil Country. Then, Florida State hosts Chattanooga. And in the nightcap, Virginia clashes with UConn and the unstoppable Donald Brown. It all starts Saturday at noon on ESPNU.
You raise me up. Strong when I am on your shoulders, raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy.
What a game, tied at 35. Morehouse trailed 28-17 at the half. They trailed 35-17 in the second half. They've scored 17 unanswered points. And they have caught Fort Valley with a little over 2.5 minutes to go. Fort Valley has won 10 straight in this series with Morehouse. They've won 28 of the 34 games all time. But right now, Morehouse is threatening to get out of the building with a win. It's 35-all. An extremely hot day. We expected in the second half that Fort Valley, who's a little bit more used to these conditions, would have the edge. Maybe they have the edge in conditioning, but Morehouse has made the big plays, at least they have in the last 5 minutes. And this ball is out of bounds. So we'll see if DeAndre Clark will take the option of taking the ball at the 40. Or he'll force them to kick again. This year in college football, if the kickoff goes out of bounds, you get it at the 40 as opposed to the 35.
That was a big mistake. That's not what you want if you're Morehouse, is to kick the ball out of bounds once you've just tied the football game up with a little bit of time left. Wow.
It looks like they're going to make Morehouse kick it again. So going to move this one back.
Now, Dave, would you?
I'm taking the ball to 40.
Taking the ball to 40.
I'm taking the ball at the 40-yard line.
The only reason I can think of right now is that they've had some big returns. You know, they opened the game with a kickoff return for a touchdown, so maybe he's banking a huge play and get them back down, or maybe score. You know, I guess he figures that his returnmen are that good.
Now, Doug, this scenario was talked when the new rules came into effect. This scenario was discussed quite a bit at the SEC preseason meetings, that if Henge would kick this ball out of bounds, Fort Valley would get the option to start at their own 45.
Wow.
So they're bypassing a chance here to take the ball at their own 40-yard line to make Morehouse kick again. Let's see how this works out. Lock it. 20, 30, 35. So rather than take the ball at the 40, they'll start this drive from the 35-yard line. What a drive by the Maroon Tigers of Morehouse the last time they had the ball. And there were an awful lot of missed tackles defensively here for Fort Valley. 1, 2, 3.
And with the game hinge he's been having, I mean, you have to put a body on that kid. If not, he's going to hurt you like he just did. And then you see right here, Quincy Avery gets free and gets down and stretches out 6 points. Right, Morehouse is back in this football game. He's tied it up, and 2 minutes left to see who's gonna pull out with a win.
Both teams with one timeout remaining. And they try to hand the ball off and nowhere to go. And Mario Lane, who was suspended in the first half for a fight he got into last week at Benedict, has been a factor here in the second half.
Yeah, he's definitely a playmaker. They missed him in the first half, but he's trying to get in and make some plays now to make up for what he missed.
Hey.
This has already been an extremely long game, 3.5 hours, and we could be staring at overtime here. Second and 12. Williams, who's thrown 4 touchdowns today, on the rollout. And this one's going to the bench area, so it's third and 12.
Set up.
And unless Fort Valley can convert on this long third down, it looks like Rich Freeman and Morehouse are going to get the ball back.
And I know that Fort Valley did not want to have a series like this. You know, of course, the game is tied up, but if they don't move the ball, they're going to give Morehouse the ball back and with pretty decent field position and put them in position to come and win, take this game from them.
Well, you got to imagine that Fort Valley might be looking for Lockett here. He's at the bottom of your screen on third and a dozen from the 33. It's Lockett. And the ball went right through his hands, incomplete. He was open, he had the first down, and the ball went right through there.
I think Mr. Lockett may have heard footsteps right here. As you see, he's got underneath and above him coverage, and ball just sneaks right through. You've not seen that from him all afternoon. He's caught everything thrown his way, and ball had a little zip on it. It just got right by him.
Grubbs on the punt. Tyderick Williams is back to receive the kick. He's at the Morehouse 22-yard line, a minute 47. Kicks away, nearly blocked. Short kick. Williams will take it at the 31. Cross the 40. And that's where he'll be marked down. In fact, they'll mark him at the 39-yard line. 8-yard return. A little over 90 seconds for Morehouse to operate. They have one timeout left.
And now it's a situation where if you're Fort Valley, you don't have to just defend against a touchdown. You have to defend on keeping them out of field goal range. I'm not sure what stripes range is. But if you know right now, 3 points wins this football game.
Sterling didn't start this game, but it looks like he's going to finish it for sure. 332 yards passing, 4 touchdowns, 3 interceptions, 1 return for a score. A little Sunday afternoon ESPNU college football out of the SIAC looks like a pretty good idea right now. This has been a tremendous game. And counting down to the finish, we don't know which way this one's going to break. Sterling on first down, the throw, pass is caught, Williams. And he's able to get forward for maybe a gain of 3 up near the 42-yard line. Clock is running.
And Tyderick Williams should have gotten out of bounds on that play. And right now, Morehouse needs to hurry up and get their offense lined up, call a play, because they're burning seconds off the clock, which they don't have.
4 wide. Trips to the top. Stedman to the bottom. It's one-on-one coverage for Stedman. He's got the football. And a flag is down. There was an awful lot of contact. Stedman's got the football down near the 25-yard line. And it's going to be a face mask penalty against Fort Valley.
That is huge. And Stedman comes up huge.
There it is.
He made all the big plays last week. He had 93 yards receiving with a long 35-yarder called back. And he's been quiet in the first half of this game, but when they've needed him in the second half to make big catches, he's done just that. He does it again right here.
So face mask penalties are all 15 yards now, and that's going to come into play here. So suddenly now Morehouse is well within field goal range. They have led in this game. They led 10-7. They led 17-14 with 6 minutes to go in the first half, but they trailed 28-17. They trailed 35-17. Now they're driving and we're tied at 35. Handoff inside, fullback. Pinckney's had some big carries in this game.
Morehouse right here, they're just going to grind the ball down and they need to hurry up and get lined up if they're going to run another play.
They have one timeout remaining. We're down to 15 seconds. And Rich Freeman may take it all the way down right here. And that is the plan. 6 seconds left. The field goal team will come on. Now Strife had two short field goal misses last week against Benedict. He had one from 30 yards that hit the crossbar. He made a 40, but he also missed another relatively short one.
And with that being said, I would have tried to go for the end zone on that last play, at least to see if we can get six out of it, but he's going to put it all on the leg of Michael Strife.
College football action continues on ESPNU Thursday night as Tennessee Tech, the Golden Eagles, face Southeast Missouri State's Red Hawks. College football primetime on ESPNU Thursday at 7:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. So Strife is on to kick a potential game-winning field goal. He's got two field goals today. He made a 33-yarder to start the scoring in the first period, and early in the fourth, he hit a 20-yarder. 24-yard attempt, it'll come from the left hash. Snap is good. Kick is up and good. 24-yard field goal, third of the day, the biggest for Micah Strife, the junior from Decatur, Georgia.
I tell you, Morehouse showed some intestinal fortitude today, coming from behind. I mean, the quarterback fairly throwing three interceptions. He hangs in there, puts his team in the position. Now they're going to get out here with a win.
They lost a heartbreaker to Benedict last week, 7-3. Fort Valley came in with tons of momentum after beating Clark Atlanta last week. Fort Valley had a 17-point lead at 35-17. When Bernard Goodrum returned an interception 46 yards for a score. But since then, Morehouse has scored 20 unanswered points. And they are on the verge of collecting their first conference win of the year. Only 2 seconds remain.
Dave, were you expecting this much offense today?
Absolutely not.
I know I wasn't.
Absolutely not.
I definitely wasn't.
We were led to believe that Morehouse, from what they did last season and the way they played against Benedict, that they would be a defensive-minded team.
And then with the problems Morehouse had last week, only mustering 157 yards of offense, I did not expect the type of performance that they put on today. With all the injuries and his inconsistencies on offense, I was not expecting this type of offensive production from either team.
They're 2 seconds away from snapping a 10-game losing streak to Fort Valley and winning for only the 7th time in 35 all-time meetings. Here's the kick. It's Lockett. Time has expired. Trying to pick up some blockers. Morehouse trying to force him in. Play is still alive. Across the 30, the 40. Into Morehouse territory, but that is gonna do it. A tremendous game out of the SIAC. Lots of offense. We expected defense, and on a day where they didn't have any fans or cooling implements on their side of the field, Morehouse comes storming back. They score the final 20 points of this game. They win 38-35. Doug Chapman, great game. Final comment.
Great game. Morehouse did not quit. They stuck around, hung around, made big plays when they needed to, and they got out of here able to win.
Thanks for watching today. Morehouse 38, Fort Valley State 35. Coming up next on ESPNU, ABC's Saturday afternoon college football coverage, the replay of a tremendous game, Ole Miss at Wake. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Doug Chapman, I'm Dave Weekly. So long from Fort Valley.